You're just moments away from a brand new episode of WTF Nations Radio's Pop Culture Warrior, hosted by the dynamic duo CQ and Radar. Pop Culture Warrior is your number one source for all things entertainment. If it's happening in TV, movies, video games, or comedy, they're all over it. And don't forget to say hi in the comments below. And while you're at it, let the boys know what you think and what you'd like to hear them talk about. Now strap in and get comfortable, because you're in for one hell of a ride. This is Pop Culture Warrior. Shots.
Broadcasting live from the basement of the Pentagon. This is WTF Nation Radio.
Welcome one and all. Today is December 21st, 2021. This is episode 84. Of Pop Culture Warrior, and it's also the last episode of 2021. It's the show where I stay up to date on all the ins and outs of what's happening in pop culture so you don't have to. I am CQ, like the little box says. I'm the Pop Culture Warrior, and with me, as always, is the inker to my colorist, the man in the bubble, the voice of the unpop culture, Mr. Radar! What's up, buddy? Say hi, Radar!
Hi, Radar!
What's going on, man? It is Tuesday night.
It is. It's Tuesday.
It is Tuesday.
Wait, hold on.
Yeah.
Why do I have subtitles?
You got subtitles?
I got subtitles on my stream. Does everyone else have subtitles? Is that a thing now?
Jesus. Are you getting distracted by your...
I'm getting distracted. I can read what I say, but not as I say it, like slightly delayed. And this is a thing.
Squirrel.
Jesus Christ. It's been a day too. I shouldn't even use that word combination. It's like his birthday coming up.
Oh man.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
So.
Oh, hi Corey.
Hey everybody. Quick shout out to everybody that's on. Let's see who's out there. Steven! As always, a fine penis to you as well, sir. Jeremy Johnson, what's going on? Heath. What's good? David. Got Max a lot in the house on YouTube. What's up, Max? David. Who else we got? Captain Wayne in the house. What up, Captain Wayne? WTF is up. That is right. It is. Pavel? Goddamn. Good name, man. I like that. Rock that. Pavel. Who else we got? Corey. What's up, Corey? He says, sup, ZQ. Sup, Radar. Sup, guy. Maxalot put in quotes, say hi, Radar.
Hi, Radar.
Maxalot says, your subtitle radar senses are tingling.
Right? Maybe it's because I watched that. There was a movie that came out this weekend. Did you hear about it?
No. No, a movie.
A little movie. I don't know. Maybe you saw it. It was something about movie. Going home. Something about you can't come home or something.
Movie.
I don't remember.
Movie. No movie. That doesn't ring a bell. Real quick before we talk
Hawkeye.
About Hawkeye. Hawkeye was out. What's up from the UK, man? Steven dialing in from the UK. What's up, brother? Good day? No, that's Australia.
That's
Australian. How do you say like what's up in England?
Just what's up? I don't know. Yo.
Hey, I'm trying to think of like a British accent. I got nothing. I got nothing.
An accent, dude, it's not gonna go well.
I got nothing, man. I can barely pronounce names. Don't get me started on accents. Top of the morn. There you go. Top of the morn. No, wait, no, that's like, isn't that Irish?
I'm pretty sure that's Ireland.
You know,
but Ireland's part of the United Kingdom.
Hello, oi, hey Pookie with the oi,
that's, oi,
oi, oi, oi,
that's
oi.
Australian too. I think all those are Australian. I'm not sure.
Hey up, mate. Is that really it? Oh, please tell me that's a real thing. Hey up, mate.
Sure. Well, he's there. I feel like he would know.
But he could be trolling, though.
He could be.
Could be trolling. But if that's true, screw it.
Right now.
I want to believe it. I'm going to CQ stamp of approval. Hey up, mate.
Hey up, Cocker. Nice.
North of Kitty. Hey up, Cocker. I like that. Let's not get bent. Real quick, coming up on the show today, in the second hour, we've got Matt Haley joining us for an interview. Again, not a name that's probably super well known, but this is a guy who drew for Marvel. He drew for DC. He's done stuff in movies. He's done stuff in TV. He's a big collaborator with Stan Lee. I mean, the dude knows his stuff. He's going to be coming on the show later on to tell us all about it. I'm excited. Excited to talk about that stuff. Also, quick bit of housekeeping. I'm putting the word out there. I'm giving you guys time. At the end of January, actually, it's going to be the first episode of February. It's like February 1st, February 2nd. I don't know. I got to double check the date. First Pop Culture Warrior of February. We are officially doing the roast of CQ. So if you think you got what it takes to come up with a sick burn, a good joke, a good pun, whatever have you, and you want your 5 seconds of fame, write it down, record it, submit it, whatever, send it to me on any of the social medias, Pop Culture Warrior on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, doesn't matter.
Oh, not Grindr.
Not on Grindr.
We got our Grindr page taken.
That got taken down. We're too raw. My OnlyFans, you know, if you want to get up on the OnlyFans, my Patreon, whatever, throw it at me. We will use it. We will use it during the roast. I'm having real comedians come on and take their shot. I want you, the audience, staff members of the WTF Nation Radio. It is open to you as well. So Pookie, Kaz, Ice, Mom, Spanky, if you got it, bring it.
Pookie already brought it. It has already bring been it. Brought in.
CQ is DC, but he's no Marvel. All right. That's cute. Write that one down. Record it. But we will definitely use it. We're going to do it. We're going to have a fun night. We'll do the roast of CQ. No limits. Oh, yeah. Steve, if you want to do a live penis that night, man, bring it. We're going to use it. I'm going to use it all. Don't do video of the penis. You can do audio of the penis.
That's for the OnlyFans.
Oh, man. Yes, Shipwreck. It is open season. Open season on CQ. Happy hunting, boys. So you got a full month and change to come up with your biggest, best CQ burns. And I'm excited. I welcome the challenge. Bring the smoke. I'm ready for it. With that.
Yeah.
You seen the latest episode of Hawkeye?
Yeah, there was some Hawkeye.
Yeah, it was a good episode, man.
First off, I want to say words about it. Remember how the other day they were like, it's going to break the internet.
I know, right?
I don't think it really broke the internet.
It was good.
It was good. It was good.
Even great.
And it was probably, okay, I'll go so far as saying this. Mm-hmm. Of the Disney Plus shows that have been on, mm-hmm. that has been one of the best single episodes to come out of it, I think.
I have to agree with you. I have to agree with you. I've watched it three times, and that's something I can't say about a lot of the Disney Plus episodes. Like, they're great shows and everything, but it's like you watch it once, you're like, all right, cool, I got it. I watched it three times, and, you know, the cold open with Yelena in the past, and that shot of the... That's our first shot of someone being blipped and de-blipped? Re-blipped?
Yes.
Unblipped?
Yep.
Unblipped.
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 Reanimated.
Reanimated. sorry.
Rehydrated. She was rehydrated. Rehydrated. She was turned to dust.
Yep.
And then now she's not dust.
She was hydrated and then rehydrated? She was dehydrated and then rehydrated. Dehydrated? Yes. Yeah, that sounds about right. Anyway. Semantics with CQ and Radar on Tuesday nights. So that shot was so good, and it's our first real look, because, you know, we never really got an unblipping shot when we saw Endgame, and then we saw that with WandaVision, when they showed Monica Rambeau coming back into existence. That was our first kind of shot at that. But
we didn't see her come reanimated, though. We just saw her in the hospital room.
Right. Well, no, we saw the, like, all the pieces came together, and she was like, and she came back. But so, like, my point is that we've seen the dusting, and we've seen the reanimation, but we never really saw, like, it both happening in real time. Like, what was the experience for that person? So, like, for her, where it was like she looks down, she sees her hands just kind of disappear, and then the rest of her disappears, and then it's like right back. Like, for them, it was like literally a blip. It was a second. And then it was so cool to shot how very, like, horror movie-esque. I think of, like, Silent Hill, where, like, the walls start peeling.
Yes.
And it's like she reconstituted and it's like reality warped around her. When in reality, we know she would have just reconstituted in the room as it's standing. But it's like, but to her perception, it's changing real time, which was such a cool shot. I just, visually speaking, it was such a great shot. CQ learned the bees, birds and the bees from action figures. So what if I did? So what if I did?
There was a bee action figure. I feel like there was. Is that a DC villain? The honey bee?
The bee. Yeah, the bird and the bee. What? Oh, my God. They got to make a team. You know, like Hawk and Dove, the team up? They got to make, like, a bird and bee team up. It's like, you just been got by the bird and the bee. Anyway, sorry. Side tangent. Great episode. Lots of good action. The scene between Haley Steinfeld's Kate Bishop and Yelena, what a great scene. That back and forth between the two ladies was phenomenal. I loved it. Loved it. And what's her name? Florence Pugh. She played it so perfectly.
She did.
Right? It's very aloof, but under that, you can feel that she is a trained interrogator. Like, she's interrogating Kate Bishop, but through a veil of, like, hey honey, hey, what's up, like, this is great, you're funny. But, like, it's not that it's necessarily an act, but it's like the true motivation is always there, and, like, right. I'm just gonna be overtly friendly. It's a classic interrogation tactic, right? You know, like, we've seen it before, where, you know, good cop, she's playing good cop, but it's the interrogation is happening.
But do you think she was interrogating her, or do you think she was actually really? I think there's a certain. She spared her life on the deal.
Yeah,
I mean, she could have at least wounded her. Okay, I don't know. Like, I don't know that they're not firing broadheads. I don't know how these arrows hurt anybody. But whatever. I'm only an archery hunter. But anyway, so that target point would have probably hurt her relatively poorly.
Sure.
on the top
it would
of
stung
that.
It would have stung a bit.
It would have hurt. It would have stuck in her shoulder probably from. And I don't even know whether using recurves and not like compound bows that have a lot more power. But we're not. Those are again semantics, whatever.
Semantics. schematics with radar and CQ. That's our other
anyway.
Show.
So what? She obviously knew that she spared her, right? So, I mean, there has to be like a certain amount of compassion there for her instead of, you know, there she was trying to maybe kind of de-escalate the things too. And I'm sure it was part of an interrogation in a way to see what she knew and what she didn't know. But also how much of it was just trying to relate to somebody who's kind of in the same line of business that she may be able to use as an ally in the future as well.
Right. You guys are funny in the chat, man. I was just reading the chat. You guys are funny.
These rants are getting, or these are getting funny. But we gotta save them.
Yeah. Yeah. Say, I'm not gonna collect. Don't message them to me now. Like,
yeah, we're gonna forget.
Send them in an like in the inbox. Don't just put them in the chat.
The second out, this guy at Mountain Dew turns into Shinerbach, and I'm going to forget.
To Pookie, I'm gonna answer Pookie because he goes, "What happened to the poor people that got blipped when they were like on a flight, and then re-blipped, and you know they just or driving down the highway, and then you reappear like in the high-" So, in the writers, I know the writers talk about this, like in their mind, when Hulk did the snap and brought everybody back, part of that stipulation is to bring them back safely. So if you got blipped in mid-flight, you know, you might be where you know, as close to where you were as safely as possible. We did see that one scene in Spider-Man Far From Home, that like when the band members came back and like the one tuba kid got railed by the basketball player because they were in the middle of the gymnasium. But anyway, I digress. Show me your with them. Dude, you guys are lit. You guys are lit in the chat. I love it.
Something.
Love it.
It's the edibles are good there tonight.
Yeah, you guys are going to town. I love it. Save it for the roast.
So back to Hawkeye, because that's all I really care about.
So we
talked about the fight scene, right? And we talked about Yelena.
Yeah, we talked about the interrogation. Yeah.
And then let's see what else we got going on in there. We got the ending.
Yep.
But I don't want to get to that yet.
Yeah, I mean, because there was a lot, right? Because it's like they kind of broke up, and then they kind of worked back together, and then you had the Ronin Maya fight scene, where Clint is like, "I'm sorry for what I have to do now. I'm sorry for my sins," and like dresses up as Ronin again and fights Maya, basically telling her, "Hey, yeah, I killed your dad. I did it, but I was there because one of your own men tipped me off." Like, one of your own men, your boss wanted your dad dead, and somebody tipped me off to be here that night. So you should think about that. And that gets her thinking about, like, who wasn't there that night?
Right.
Who and wasn't her boyfriend, there?
Dude. Are they fucking, or what's going on with
that? I don't think so. I've never gotten a romantic vibe from that.
I don't get much of a romantic vibe from her at all.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah,
she's a very angry person.
She's stone cold, man. She's
stone something.
Dead inside.
She's very. God, I don't know. I don't know the word. I don't. Stone cold as it doesn't seem fucking heartless enough.
Yeah, she is. She is through and through.
Self, kind of feel bad for her. But anyway, back to the story.
Yes.
He didn't actually kill anybody in that fight, though, did he?
We don't know. We just see him like do the Batman thing where he drags guys off screen.
Right. But I didn't. Yeah, we didn't see him actually like kill anybody.
No. And we know he didn't kill the first guy. He knocked him out because he shows up later. As far as I understand, I'm not reading that comment.
I will.
It's from YouTube, so I don't know if you're gonna see it.
Not the inbox is dirtier than the dumpsters behind the Flying J.
No, that's fine. I'm not reading Max a lot. I'm not reading that out loud. I'll shoot it to Radar in a message. he's asking you directly.
But we got the fight scene, mm-hmm. and that kind of was unproductive, honestly.
I mean,
it was a draw. I mean, let's be honest. He could have killed her and didn't.
I mean, he could have. He could have. He absolutely could have.
Probably. I don't know.
The answer is probably. excuse me. Anyway.
Like a dying goat.
Anyway. Whatever. So obviously we get to the big reveal at the end of the episode, and this is the thing that was like, I mean, I'm not gonna say I called it.
You did call it.
But I called it. I mean, I really called it.
You both were kind of right.
I mean, I called it exactly.
That the mom.
I'm gonna
get a hold.
Yeah, you did call. We said the mom was sketch from the beginning. We said she was sketchy from the beginning.
I called the mom was going to call Val.
Right. Which Val. She probably didn't call Val. She probably called Kingpin. Spoiler alert.
I doubt it went up. I bet it went down.
I think she called Kingpin. I think she works directly for Kingpin. That's why we see a picture of the two of them together at the end of the episode. And then Kingpin probably got Val to go hire the Black Widow.
Everyone watched it. It was a week ago.
We're talking about it. I don't know.
Because like you said, you were absolutely right about having to have Kingpin in this universe to have other things happen in Spider-Man.
Correct.
As far as I'm going to go,
they would tie together. Yes.
They would tie together, and that does make a lot of sense, and it did. Mm-hmm. Now, speaking of, is this going to be a spoiler for Spider-Man that happens at Christmas?
I don't think so.
Okay. Is it the same Christmas? That's what I want to break that down, because
yes,
it happens at Christmas.
I 100% yes, 100%, 100% yes. In fact, I just read an interview. I can send you the link too, where the Hawkeye directors spoke out. Like literally, this is the title of the interview. Hawkeye directors break silence about the Spider-Man No Way Home crossover. Meaning, and they talk about specific, like, when we talk about the Statue of Liberty, when we talk about Rogers the Musical, like, those are those two properties crossing over. Not necessarily that we're going to see Spider-Man, which I still say is a very good possibility. Daniel in the chat says, hopefully there's something in correlation to the last scene in No Way Home and the fight scene that we know is coming at 30 Rock at the Rockefeller Center in the season finale. That would be epic. That's what I was – look. Okay. Wait, okay.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Can we just talk about both of them? Okay, look. Mm-hmm. Do the spoiler thing.
Oh, because
we're going to talk about both. Sure. Talk about both.
There it is.
If you haven't seen Spider-Man No Way Home, you want to, let's talk about it.
Sure.
Okay. So –
Spider-Man No Way Home spoilers.
All three Spider-Men. What Spider-Man are we talking about being there? Because he doesn't have any of his tech anymore.
Right.
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 So he doesn't have any buddies. He doesn't have any friends. He doesn't have anything.
Nothing.
He doesn't. I mean, he knows Hawkeye, but Hawkeye doesn't know him.
Correct. He would not know.
He doesn't have any way to communicate with them.
Right.
Fucking Hawkeye wouldn't know. I don't know. This is what I don't understand. Like, people know Spider-Man.
Yes.
Right?
But nobody knows Peter Parker.
But nobody knows Peter Parker is Spider-Man.
Correct.
And people know Peter Parker is Peter Parker, right? Like, if his classmates know him.
I mean, how do you think he rented a room?
Right. Well, with his ID.
Yeah.
But no, they don't give a shit. But yeah, they don't give a shit. But I'm just saying, like, no. But I'm saying, if people he went to school with, this is what I don't understand about, like,
yeah,
his friends in high school. Like, they just don't know Peter Parker, Spider-Man. They probably liked him fine at school.
Yeah.
This is why I don't understand the whole thing. Right. Like,
there's a bit. There's okay. So there's a bit of like, Like, if the idea is that the spell at the end says nobody remembers Peter Parker as Spider-Man, then you would think, oh, well, when he walks into the place, they're like, oh, yeah, you're that kid from school.
Yep.
But they don't.
They just don't know that he is Spider-Man.
So I still, like, I believe.
They didn't really explain it.
I believe he wanted everyone to forget Peter Parker. Just forget Peter Parker exists.
Okay.
Not to say that he doesn't. You know what I mean? When he meets somebody, he goes, hey, I'm Peter Parker. Oh, hey, Peter Parker. Is this everybody that knew him and knew that he was Spider-Man, knew all that, just he just doesn't exist anymore. He doesn't exist to them. That's why, like, he could reintroduce himself. They would just forget everything previously.
Right. So he's still going to fight crime because he's a friendly neighbor with Spider-Man.
Right, of course. Of course.
But, okay, but right now, if this is in the exact same universe, right? Mm-hmm. The exact same universe, exact same time frame, okay? Mm-hmm. He's not going to really know what to do, or he's got to kind of learn how to be Spider-Man without all of his Stark.
Sure. But you see right there at the end, like, he's listening to the police scanner and he's going out looking for trouble. I mean, like, that's his thing, is he's going
to. And that might have been when he was talking about this police scanner, that might have been the fight going on with Rockefeller Center.
It very well could have been. I mean, it's strange that he rented a room. I think like, I don't know if they call it out specifically, but I figured he would be back in Queens, which is where he's from.
Yeah.
So to rent a room there, why would he web all the way to Rockefeller Center specifically? You know what I mean? Like, that's a strange, of all the places in the city, New York City is very big, believe it or not. And of all the places he could web around there at the closing, for it to close right over Rockefeller Center is such a strange just decision. If it has nothing to do with the final scene of Hawkeye, is all I'm saying.
In all fairness, I don't think that that production team really gave a fuck about the Disney Plus shows.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
Like, it might
have been like a cool job. That, but didn't they put Rogers the Musical in the movie? Like, they put the billboards for it?
Yeah. But I'm just, okay, like, I don't know, like, how much. I don't, because we've been told on several occasions that, like, the writers for Spider-Man or whatever don't have access to Hawkeye, and the people from Hawkeye didn't have access to this other, you know what I mean?
Sure.
They didn't have access to the ending of Black Widow and the post-credit scene. They didn't know any of that. So it's kind of hard to, like, it's kind of hard to discern, like, what they know and when they know, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, like, to say, I mean, because, okay, Christmas at Rockefeller Center, like, I landed in LaGuardia, and I took off from LaGuardia. I was there for 4 hours. Mm-hmm. That's the extent of my New York City fucking experience. Mm-hmm. But I know that Christmas and the Christmas tree and the ice skating Rockefeller Center is a thing.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
So to have that as a scene is not that far out there just to be, it's a cool scene.
Sure.
You know what I mean? And, you know, when they're talking about, oh, we go to the top of the Empire State Building, or I like to go to the top of this one. Yeah. You know what I mean? So to have... To have it be a thing is a thing.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. Could it be? I'd be cool as shit if he was.
Now,
but I just don't know, like, how it's going to. And then, okay.
Yeah. I mean,
we have a lot of questions in the air as to what's going to happen to Peter Parker now and Spider-Man.
Sure. Right?
So, if you put him in, does that answer any questions? Does it make more questions? Like, what is? We don't know contractually. He has, like, another.
Is another appearance.
Is another appearance in another MCU property. That's all it said, right?
Right. Now, how surprising would it be if that other... Because remember, they never said, like, oh, he's going to be in another Avengers movie. He's going to be in another Superman. They just said he has another appearance. What if it's the end of Hawkeye? That's his contract.
I feel like it'd be more. Right? I feel like that, because, okay, hear me out. Like, this one didn't have, like, they talked about having Doctor Strange and WandaVision, but they didn't.
Right.
They talked about having other characters in these Disney Plus shows because of money.
Sure.
Basically, I mean, let's be honest, because those guys make a lot of fucking money. Sure, and to have them in there, to have, you know, someone in Tony Stark in one of these movies, that you got to pay a bunch of fucking money to have them in there. Kind of thing. Right?
Yeah.
So that's kind of why we're seeing more minor characters, I think. As they're picking up traction, I think
more. Partly.
what, because so, I don't know, when WandaVision came out, they weren't sure how these were going to be received, right? They thought it was going to be well, but they did a lot of advertising when that first came out, and the numbers when it first came out weren't as high as they were hoping.
Yeah.
So now they're trying to gotta figure things out.
AJ McKinnon in the chats, on YouTube chats, says that, sorry, but Matt Murdock was the biggest surprise to me, and also this storyline has created so many questions. For me personally, Matt Murdock wasn't a surprise. I mean, there were a lot of rumors that he was going to appear, so there was that. Had I not heard the rumors, maybe I'd be more surprised. But again, once I saw Kingpin in the episode of Hawkeye, I went, and I think I messaged you, Radar. I think I messaged you.
Yep.
100% Daredevil's in Spider-Man. Like, even if it's a scene, even if it's just a scene, 100%. You do not put Kingpin in Hawkeye days before Spider-Man comes out and not have Charlie Cox's Daredevil in it.
Right.
I said it without a shadow of a doubt. So that wasn't that much of a surprise.
Well, when we talk about that, like, you kind of forecasted that last Tuesday, that was the reason Kingpin, because you tied all that together. You said Kingpin's going to be in on Wednesday, so that way on Thursday he can Daredevil can be in No Way Home.
Yep,
you said that.
I did.
So you were right.
I kind of wanted to clip it and play it tonight, but I was you know what? I'm the bigger man. I'm not going to do it. Okay, let me play the clip.
Because that was a good one. But yeah, it was a really good. That was a funny little scene.
Yeah. Which, by the way, sorry, that brought up a good point. Shout out to the actual King Smith, because he gave me an idea. He goes, you always make these declarations, and then don't have a way to kind of, I don't know, go back and find it. So I'm going to start doing like a segment or something, or the same way I have this little spoiler warning alert. I want to put up like a bold prediction, you know, and that way it's going to be easy to find in the replay. Cause like this little sticker thing will be here, but it's gonna be like bold prediction. I think Wilson Fisk Kingpin shows up in episode this of Hawkeye, and then Spider-Man, Charlie Cox shows up as, you know, Daredevil, Matt Murdock. And then that way I'll be able to find all my bold predictions. So I'm gonna start doing that.
Okay. That's a good one. I like that one. Yeah. I think it was a good prediction, and I think it was right on the money, because it was right.
Damn right it was.
Okay, now kind of flipping back to, let's get back to our Hawkeye Spider-Man conglomerate.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Where does Hawkeye go now? Does he go after Fisk at all? Or is that just that's too much. He just wants to get this done.
It's already been announced that Maya is getting a spinoff, an Echo spinoff.
Yes.
And I think, no confirmation, I think that'll be a show where she's trying to hunt down Kingpin, right? Okay. She's going to hold, in her mind, she holds him responsible for her father's death, and she's trying to, like, go super vigilante style and take him down. So okay. I think he gets out of it. Like, I think he's going to make an appearance, maybe do a little fighty-fighty, but I think this is just setting the stage for that series down the line. I think this series wraps up with more of the Hawkeye, Kate Bishop, Yelena kind of triangle is going to be the ending thing, and the Tracksuit Mafia.
Sorry, my tinnitus is going crazy. Are we going to have Daredevil in Hawkeye, do you think?
No, but maybe in Echo.
Okay.
I could see him coming back to portray, you know, if you're going to bring Kingpin back.
God, that was funny. When he grabbed that brick, he's like, I'm a really good lawyer.
He's a really good lawyer. But I love, did you see how Spider-Man was about to catch it too?
Yep.
But Daredevil was actually not necessarily faster, because he was just closer to the window. Closer, they were both
to the back of him, and he's blind.
Yeah,
so
it's just almost bam. Yep. But I love that, like, that they were both within an instant of catching it. It's just, but since, you know, Daredevil was closer to the window, he caught it. But, you know, this is just crazy.
So let's get back to our bold predictions here. Mm-hmm. So we're not gonna see Daredevil in this show.
I do not believe so. No.
Are we gonna see Kingpin at all more in this show? Do you think?
Or I think there will be a set up. Especially since Vincent D'Onofrio was name dropped in the credits. You can't think
because he had that picture.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. Like, you can't think that just because there was a picture there. Like he's gonna get credited. I mean, obviously you gotta credit the guy that's in it. But like I really feel he's going to make an appearance. It might be a scene or two. It might not be much, but he'll make an appearance. And it's gotta be because Maya has to engage in a way that says like, "Oh, I'm coming for you," right? To set that up for the future. So there has to be that. Like he's like, "Yeah, I killed your father, and what?" You know what I mean? Like something to set that stage so that like we send her off to her own thing, right. But we've been,
I don't know, as much of a quote unquote as a surprise it was, but it really wasn't. They've been teasing that since basically the beginning of the show.
Sure,
right. So, but now that he's here, now that he's been confirmed, mm-hmm. right? How many episodes do we have left? Two.
Yeah. No. Oh, for Hawkeye, no, one episode. This tonight's episode is the last episode.
Oh,
finale.
That's all.
Yeah.
God damn it. So, really.
Mm-hmm. Final episode.
Damn it. Then what are we going to do?
I can tell you the next comic book property to come out, now that Spider-Man's out and now that Hawkeye wraps up tonight, the next property would be Morbius in January. So you have to wait till January to see Morbius in theaters. Then Uncharted in February and then The Batman in March.
And we're not going to get another film release until May, huh?
Yeah, we don't get another Marvel MCU film release till May. I think prior to that, we'll probably see one to two more Disney Plus shows. I think we'll see Miss Marvel. That's already been finished filming a while back. So I think we'll see Miss Marvel and then possibly either like Moon Knight or She-Hulk or one of those shows come right around, you know, by the time we get to Multiverse of Madness, which is going to be awesome.
Yeah. Well, let's see. We got Ms. Marvel. Ms. Marvel is not coming until summer of 2022, it said.
Ms. Marvel? Summer of 2022? I think they've had success with Disney Plus shows leading up to the premiere of a Marvel movie. I don't know if you've noticed that, but they've been, that's been like kind of the trajectory. Like we had the Disney show that ran up to Black Widow.
I think part of with that too, like, is they had them ready to release, right? They had the stuff that, and they were kind of finishing up on it because they kind of pushed all that stuff back with the films and whatever. So they had that kind of stockpile, you know, because what, freaking Black Widow was supposed to be released before COVID,
right?
Or right as COVID,
Yeah, March.
They had it ready to roll. Same with Shang-Chi, they pushed that back quite a bit.
So that's
right.
But that's what I'm saying. I think they've seen success in having a Disney show kind of lead up to a major release, and I think that they're gonna like, oh, this has been working for us. Let's keep that rolling. So I think with Doctor Strange being, because it just got pushed back a couple weeks ago. With Doctor Strange getting pushed back to May, they'll make the decision to, okay, let's roll out a show leading up to it. And Daniel is right. Peacemaker is in January as well. That'll be an HBO Max show, Peacemaker with John Cena, based on the Suicide Squad character, Peacemaker. So
yeah, but that's not MCU.
That's not MCU. But I mentioned the Batman, which is not MCU either. So it's a good point. Right. Fair point.
I'm just saying, okay, for me, I don't really give a shit about all that stuff. Let's see, Disney Plus.
Yeah, so that. But so to talk about Spider-Man real quick, huge, huge props to Spider-Man. Because even given that we're still in the pandemic, and honestly, during the big Omicron variant, speaking of variants, that's happening right now, Spider-Man No Way Home got to number two all-time release.
Yes.
In theaters. Not counting for inflation, obviously. They don't count inflation. But $260 million.
Yes.
Opening weekend. That is crazy. And it just beats out Avengers Infinity War, which hit 257.6 was Infinity War. So it beat it by less than $2.5 million. It beats out Infinity War. Obviously, Avengers Endgame, I don't think a movie's ever going to hit that opening. 357 domestic all time. Like, that's...
But okay, crazy. I'm gonna throw a couple audibles for that though, because there are still theaters that are closed down a pandemic.
Sure.
There are places, like, I know I went to the theater here in town, which is fucking shitty and podinky or whatever. But so I went, they have like two theaters. One's like, I don't know, got like the nice seats, the recliners and all that shit. That one was full, but the other theater that has like the normal regular seats, every other row was blocked off. And so they only sold like half of what they could have. And then they had less show times because between the shows, they'd wipe everything down.
Right.
You know what I mean? So if every theater is tanking certain, I don't think it would have beat Endgame.
But you're saying it would have made, I mean, I think obviously.
It would have done better.
I think it would have made more money.
Pre-pandemic. Well, okay, but let me ask you this though. Because we've anticipated this movie for quite a while. Right. Because it's kind of been the big one coming down the chute, and people.
And I think the mystery around
there's an argument. There's an argument going around that the pandemic is kind of reaching a place where people don't give a fuck about it anymore. People are less scared. People are more mobile, even with the moronic variant or whatever.
Yeah.
So something like Black Widow. Was that been released earlier where people were just kind of like, is Rona still a thing? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, so if coronavirus never would have happened and we would have had, you know, Shang-Chi as a big blockbuster, we would have had Black Widow as a bigger film than it was because it wasn't half released at Disney Plus the same day. And like all these things, right?
Mm-hmm.
If we would have had that for these other previous properties, would Spider-Man has been as, would No Way Home be as big as it was kind of? I mean, there's a lot of variables to this. Like, sure. I'm playing devil's advocate a bit. I think it was a very good movie. And of the ones that I've seen, I didn't get to see Eternals.
Yeah.
Because I missed it in the theater.
Yeah, you saved yourself some money there.
Okay. But I'm just saying, of the ones that have come out since Endgame.
Yeah.
This has been one of the most, this has been the best one I've seen.
Well, yeah. Well, hands down. So, there's a lot to it. And obviously, we'll never know.
Okay, but I'm just saying, if this would have been, we'll flip this in Black Widow, time-wise, okay?
Okay.
Would the numbers, I don't think the numbers would have been as good if you would have.
Sure. Well, yeah. Yeah. Well, because, I mean, there were less theaters open at the time.
There were less theaters. And that, I still think it was smart for them to release it to Disney Plus same day.
Sure.
A higher fee. I will maintain that. I think that was a good idea on there.
Absolutely.
And, but it also did take away from that box office take, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, if that would have been released, you know, 6 months ago,
yeah,
9 months ago, that wouldn't have had quite the
sure,
the sure money made.
But then, okay, other side of that coin, if it's released pre-COVID.
Yes.
Does it make more money?
I don't know.
I think it does. I think it does.
Because I think this is the last holdouts. Me, for example, I don't like going to the theater. Okay.
Yeah.
And I didn't miss it, and not definitely down enough to fucking go sit next to a bunch of random ass people. And honestly, these motherfuckers. That's the reason I didn't want to go in the first fucking place. I sit there. I pay the money for the fucking best seats in the goddamn place. Mm-hmm. I get next to fucking 2-ton mouth breathing Tina. Who fucking has 17 bags of Skittles and all I hear the whole fuck time is I can't even hear the fucking movie. Oh man, I love how this thing bleeps me out. Anyway, back to the story. So that was my theater experience, and she's in the one ear that I can hear out of. She's sitting right next to me, going crazy with her stupid Skittles and popcorn and slurping her goddamn cup. And I wanted to rip her throat out, but there's already enough violence on the screen anyway.
It reminded
me why theaters and people are stupid.
It is true. He threw out a nice little tidbit. Highest grossing movie of all time pre-Star Wars is Gone with the Wind. good point. Now we're, remember, we're also we're not talking highest grossing all time because I mean the movie just came out. So we're talking biggest opening. Time will tell how well Spider-Man does, you know, moving forward. Like if all the hype dies down or if it keeps rolling. Yeah, I mean, I definitely think pre-COVID this movie makes more money. Again, I still don't think it beats opening weekend of Endgame because it
Endgame even like
even
before all this show, new Endgame was coming out.
Yeah, yeah, there's no way
that was a thing.
But so, does it make more money? Yes, and you can argue all you want, but the simplest fact is, well, pre-COVID there were more people in the world. I mean. Let's be honest, COVID killed a lot of people.
It just killed off old people who wouldn't have paid to go see it.
I think old people would have. Remember, Andrew, Tobey Maguire played Spider-Man nearly 20 years ago. So somebody who's in his 60s now was 40 when Tobey Maguire played Spider-Man. He'd be like, you know what? I want to see Spider-Man again. I want to see him back up, whipping some webs, you know?
But also, they didn't really advertise those guys were going to be in it. So,
Yeah, but man, the worst kept secret in Hollywood. But
honestly, okay, they had some really, really good moments on screen.
Yeah.
They did.
Yeah.
But, well, when they're trying to get Andrew Garfield, dude, you're amazing. You're amazing. That was so fun. That was pretty fucking funny.
Yeah.
But, okay. So they had some really good, funny moments on screen. And they did. It was like, what are the Avengers, a band? That was pretty funny. Yeah. Okay. But that and their interaction, all the things they did, were not the biggest surprise of the movie to me.
Okay. Hit me with it.
Ned and the fuck.
Yeah.
Where is that going to go, do you think?
Okay. So that actually leads me into the next part I did want to talk about. So real quick, I'm going to, not to do a review, but just some highlight some things that I really liked. And because I can be... I'm not a blind fanboy. There were some things I didn't like. Now, I really love this movie. Let me start with it. I really, really love this movie. I've seen it 3 times now. Really, really love this movie. And for the most part, I love it. There are tiny nitpicks, but I wanted to dig in deep to show that I can prove that I can nitpick and ding them for certain things. So first of all, positives. Big gold star goes to Andrew Garfield coming back as Peter Parker, as amazing Spider-Man. I feel like he killed every scene. Just that he, like, he didn't skip a day. Like, he just stepped off the set of Amazing Spider-Man 2. Like, the quippiness, the nerdy, chaotic energy that he get, like, it was perfect. Every scene he was in, loved it. The villains. And specifically William Dafoe, Alfred Molina, Jamie Foxx. Yes. Those three, I mean, they brought it. They went with it and really gave their all. Like, you could feel them just being the character. These are incredible actors, and they really cherish the opportunity to bring that character back, and you can feel it. You can see it. You can feel it. They're in it. They are fully, fully in it. William Dafoe, I mean, my God, he just went for it. And lastly, the big, I mean, again, because the movie was great all around, but the big up for me was that of all the MCU films, this is the first one where I really felt they got to the core of the Spider-Man character.
Okay.
Because in the MCU, we have had happy-go-lucky Peter, where everything goes right, and his mentor is the millionaire Iron Man, who gifts him this super awesome robotic suit. Like, the core of Spider-Man has always been, he's broke as fuck, he's unlucky, no one knows who he is, you know, he can't get anything right other than being Spider-Man, and half the time he gets that wrong. He has no technology, you know, depending if you're, you know, mechanical web shooters, not mechanical web shooters, but at his core, he's always just been a kid, and the core of the character has always been sacrifice, suffering. Yes. Yep. You know, his Uncle Ben died because of something he did or did not do, and he's always trying to make up for that guilt and that suffering and that sacrifice. So we've never had that version of Spider-Man in the MCU. He's never lost. The biggest loss he's faced is Iron Man dying in Avengers, and you can't even really say that's his loss. That's everybody's loss. But that wasn't right. that wasn't his loss. You felt it a little bit in Far From Home, but not necessarily that much. Whereas this movie gave us the Uncle Ben moment with Aunt May instead, and she gave him the speech, which a lot of people didn't like that she said, "With great power, there must also be great responsibility," which, yes, not the way you've heard it before, but is actually the comic book accurate way to say it. In the first time it was ever printed in the comic book, that's exactly how it came out. With great power, there must also come great responsibility. And then to end that movie where he has ditched the technology, he has ditched the friends, the family. He is living in a rundown, broke, rent-free, like practically rent-free, like, and he's just him and his cell phone on a police scanner being the friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. That, and then of course when they put on the classic blue and red, the spandex, I mean, the Lycra, whatever you want to call it, like, man, that made my heart do backflips because I'm like, that's Spider-Man, someone who is sacrificing what makes him happy for the greater good, for being the hero he needs to be. And oh my God, yes, yes. And I don't even care if they like retcon it in the next movie where he's like MJ and she's like Peter, and then like they're all having, I don't care. But the point is that they got him to that point.
Give it up. He was
exactly. Yeah. And I would love to see from here, the only way he can make money, because obviously he's got to go get his GED, is like he starts selling pictures of himself to the Daily Bugle. Like, that is, there you go. That is the holy grail of like, all right, we are classic Spider-Man now, right? He starts selling pictures of himself.
Okay, so.
Not on OnlyFans.
I like Daniel's takeaway that Toby was able to save Harry's dad and Andrew was able to save Tom's MJ. That the movie didn't just redeem your second chances to its villain, but the heroes as well.
Exactly.
And that wasn't said as much. They were like, we got to get the guy the second chance. We got to fix these guys. We got to do this.
Yeah.
You know, it came out really good. I was a big fan of it. But I think going back to the, you know, he hadn't had a loss yet. And when he finally did, those guys being there, Toby and Andrew being there to kind of help walk him through that grief.
They mentored him.
They mentored him a bit. That was really good too.
Yeah.
I was a big fan of that.
Sure. All the scenes with the three of them. But okay, so now I've said my niceties. I want to get into my negatives. I want to get to my cons.
Like 7 minutes.
We got 7 minutes. Oh my God, we're running short on time today.
We're just talking much about fucking Hawkeye.
but yes, first and foremost, the idea that Ned can just grab a sling ring and throw a portal out there, ridiculous. It's ludicrous. And I know
He can't shut it.
Well, I know they threw in hints, like in the beginning, he says like, oh, my mom said there's magic in my family and sometimes my fingers tingle or whatever. Like, they did that. There's a shot, and I saw it the second time I watched, when they're in his mom's house, they do like they paint like a pan across the walls of the kitchen. And there's like this big decorative, like, I don't even know, display case. With like knives and swords and shit, like almost like alluding to like they have some type of, I don't know, like vampire hunter background or something, like you would see in a castle, like with swords and knives and daggers and all that. Yeah. So hinting at some type of, I don't know, mystical combat training background or something, you know. And then there's the fact that the Cloak of Levitation went to him and saved him, which when we found out way back when, you got to go back to Doctor Strange, the first movie, when the cloak attached itself to Doctor Strange, you know, what was it? The other dude, Wong, and the other guy, the Baron, not the Baron. Anyway, they were like, wow, that's weird. Like, the cloak would only go to someone who it connects to magically. Like, who it sees that magic and connects to that person. So the fact that the cloak, like, we didn't see, like in the movie, we see Strange throw the cloak at Spider-Man. Like, we see him do that. That's more like a command thing. In this shot, when he's falling and all of a sudden the cloak gets him, we don't see Strange throw him the cloak. It's almost as if the cloak sees him in danger and goes to him, right? Strange was busy doing his portal shit. There's no way he would have been paying attention to seeing Ned falling and like worried about throwing the cloak to him. So that's a whole, so there's something there. What it means, you know, in the comics, Ned Leeds does become the Hobgoblin. That's one of his personas. He becomes a villain. And the idea that they tease where he goes, don't worry, Peter, I'll never become a villain and try to kill you. Like, that's kind of a nod to that. But now that Peter Parker's been wiped from his memory and he's not a friend anymore, could we see him become a villain in the future? Could we see, you know, an evil Ned and he and Spider-Man have to fight? And that, we could see that. It's possible. It's possible. So there was that. That did... It didn't feel right. It felt like they had to kind of do it story-wise, but that it didn't really like... Mm. One down that really hurts me to say this is that I don't feel Tobey Maguire gave his best performance as Peter Parker. I really, in my heart of hearts, feel that he tried to do the bare minimum. Like, he tried to just, like, I'm here... This is Tobey Maguire reading the lines of Peter Parker. And I say that because there were reports back when it was hinted that these guys were in there that said, like, the first people they got on board were, like, the villains, right? That was the big thing. They got Jamie Foxx, they got William Dafoe, they got Alfred Molina, and that the Spider-Mans were actually the harder ones to convince to come back. But they ended up getting Andrew Garfield, and rumor has it Tobey Maguire was the standout. Like, he's like, I don't want to do it. He didn't want to come back. But they kind of pigeonhole, they kind of put him in a corner because they're like, look, everybody else is back. And we're going to be making references to all the movies. If you don't want to be a part of it, then you're the asshole. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I really do feel like he came back because he's like, look, if I don't, it's going to make me look bad. I'm going to be the asshole that didn't come back for the movie, regardless of the situation or whether I wanted to do it or not. Like, he felt like he had to. And I don't know, his... I mean, that his whole Peter Parker has always been very subtle. It's always been very, you know, but I don't know. I really believe Tobey Maguire is a phenomenal actor. He is.
Yes.
Take Spider-Man away. He's an incredible actor. And I've seen, this is the one where he plays the soldier and comes home and his brother was like banging his wife and he was all PTSD and out and shit. And like, man, really went for it. Like, an incredible, incredible actor. So to see him kind of be like, hey guys, it's me, Peter. I'm Spider-Man. Like, it's just, it felt so phony to me. But that's just me.
See, I kind of, he seemed like, it kind of seemed to me, okay, that he's a lot like how I am.
Yeah.
Where he's older, right? Doesn't want to play the fuck games anymore. Just kind of want to get to the fucking meat potatoes of it.
Yeah.
I'm too old. I'm too tired to fuck around. That just fucking do this so I can go back to taking a nap.
Yeah.
That's kind of how I felt about it. You know what I mean? Like he's like, I got better shit to do. Like, I woke up here. I don't even want to fucking be here. I just want to go the fuck home and get this fucking done with.
I feel like that was the actor, not the character.
Okay, that's kind of the way. Right. That's kind of the way it felt. Like, he talked about not putting the suit on. He's not really Spider-Man anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, he doesn't do that shit anymore. Yeah. Now he's kind of in a situation where he has to.
Yeah.
That's the, you know, and that was the way the script was written. You know, he's like, I don't even do
we
that.
We are definitely, we're going to circle back and close out this Spider-Man conversation after the interview. The last thing I do want to say, though, is that I feel like they missed a golden opportunity that I'm still upset about. They didn't do the Spider-Man meme of the three Spider-Mans, like, pointing at each other, like, what?
Yes.
They didn't do that. Now, there was, and somebody told me about this, and I saw it on the second viewing, in the scene where they're doing the lab stuff, like, there's the scene where Ned goes, Peter, and they all go, like, huh? And it's very, I think, like, that was them nodding at it, but I'm like, if you don't do it in the suits, it's not worth it.
They kind of did it on the, when they were coming together and trying to make a plan. They kind of did it. They didn't do the point, but they were all three in like a triangle, kind of looking at each
that's,
other.
That's just because you have three actors in a scene together. That's
what
not.
I'm saying, like, they should have did, but they were right there. They could have did the pointy thing.
Like, I thought you were gonna do it, right? And they all just for a moment freeze on that, like. That how do you not do that? You missed a huge opportunity. Yep. So I'm angry about that they missed an opportunity. All right, guys, we're going to toss to a quick break.
Yeah, quick
and
break.
When we come back, we are going to have artist extraordinaire Matt Haley with us. He's an incredible artist. He's done stuff for Marvel. He's done stuff for DC, a bunch of other comic brands, a bunch of other TV shows, a bunch of other movies. We're going to talk all about it and his incredible career when we come back. If you guys, as always, ask questions. This interview is just as much yours as it is ours. So feel free to throw your questions in the chat about anything to do with comic books, movies, TV, whatever. And we'll be more and we'll talk more after this. I can talk, I swear. For now, let's all say goodbye to Radar. Radar. Wait, say goodbye, Radar.
Bye, Radar.
All right, we'll be after this. Be back. Bye, right after this. Shots.
You're listening to the sounds of WTF Nation Radio.
again and try to win. You never do the same mistakes again. Everybody's watching you till the end. You die and try and try again. Enjoy this real life. Out of the game, you know the way.
I stood there in that middle of church with a bottle of gin in my hand. I'm looking up at the rooftop like I'm trying to find my long lost friend. My days turn to nights, my nights turn to weeks when you're living life on the road. I'm halfway back to New Orleans with a few more drinks to go. I said, tip 'em on back. Well, let's tip 'em on back. Made it back to Bourbon Street, picking some of them old night bars, hoping I could find myself playing music on my guitar. For the kid around, they all shouted out as the drinks began to flow. I pulled out that.
You're listening to the sounds of WTF Nation Radio.
Hey everybody, welcome back, welcome back. This is Pop Culture Warrior. I am, of course, CQ. Boy, howdy, I am excited to have this conversation with our guest tonight. My guest tonight has been illustrating hit graphic novels from Marvel and DC Comics for years on characters ranging from The Defenders to Superman, and has worked with commercial clients ranging from T-Mobile to IMG Models to Sarah Silverman. He's worked on the feature documentary Comic-Con episode 4, A Fan's Hope, with director Morgan Spurlock. And he's worked on the TV series Who Wants to Be a Superhero for NBC Universal, as well as numerous other projects with Stan the Man Lee. He was the artist behind the Gotham Stories motion comic about the Fox TV series Gotham, as well as Wonder Woman 77, which was the smash hit comic set during the Linda Carter Wonder Woman years. His poster artwork has been exhibited at the 8-Bit Gallery in Los Angeles. You can check out more of this amazing man at his website, matthaley.com. But for now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our very special guest for tonight, the incredible Matt Haley, everybody. Yay! One day there'll be an applause. There'll be an applause for you. Imagine a crowd of applause for Matt Haley. How you doing, man?
I'm hanging in. Like I said, I'm a little under the weather. I apologize, but I am got some NyQuil in me, or rather some Jaeger, and so I think I'll be okay.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, so for the folks at home, guys, you know, usually I do a nice little split screen. We get our guest on camera. He's a little under the weather, so we are appreciative. I tried to talk him out of it. I swear, I tried to talk him out of it, but he was insistent on wanting to utilize his sexy, phlegmy voice to be on the show tonight. So thank you so much for your time, Matt.
Thank you.
Right out the gate, first thing I ask everybody, what is your connection to the military?
Well, I never served. I never served when I was doing comics full time. I had a lot of fans who were service members. Oddly, a lot of Marines. Semper Fi. If there's any Marines out of there. I guess a lot of service members love comic books. Maybe that's why they join up. I don't really know. But the only connection I've got to the military, and it's kind of funny, we uncovered my dad's genealogical records at the Haley side of the family, going all the way back to before the Revolutionary War. And we discovered there was a Captain Haley who served in George Washington's Continental Army three separate times. We found his pension papers. He got $80 a year.
Wow.
And I think there was some members on my mom's side who served in World War One. In fact, there might be some on my dad's side. As far as World War II, I don't actually remember, but I wouldn't be surprised. Mm. But I think after that, no. So that's going back quite a ways.
No, but I mean, you have a lineage of military that few people have. I mean, that's incredible.
Me, but. Yeah.
It's in the blood, man. It's in your blood. Right? But you did touch on something about the idea of like, oh, a lot of military veterans, you know, being fans. And I do really believe that there's a correlation for a lot of guys who serve that, yeah, like myself, who felt like good versus evil, right versus wrong, heroes and villains, and like playing into that, I don't want to say stereotype, but playing into that, you know, thing of it. I have a whole side theory about, but yeah, but sure. That, I can write a whole thesis about that, but
that makes sense, yeah.
Yeah. So as I, you know, I really pride myself in learning about my guest and doing the deep dive, getting to know you before we even get to speak.
Right.
As I was looking into you, like you've been credited. So, okay. So in the art world, let's call it, you've been credited as a colorist, a cover colorist.
God, I hope not.
Yeah, I mean, it's out there. I'm telling you, penciler.
Yeah, I draw.
Layout, inker, artist, cover artist, like all these different things. And then, but then there's the entertainment world where you've been credited as director, editor, producer, writer, costume designer, and I even found puppeteer.
Yes.
Okay. So my question is, what do you consider yourself?
I would have to say I'm a director. I got into comics when I was 20 years old. I didn't, like, I quit college. I went to college in New Mexico. Hang on a second.
Sure.
So I went to college at Eastern New Mexico University. I grew up in Albuquerque and just really didn't want to stay there. But I didn't really want to get, like, a job. You know what I mean? Like we talked before, I did some radio, and that's fine. But I really never had a 9-to-5 job. And I got in drawing comics. I was drawing Star Trek when I was 20 years old. I was a little young. You know, I couldn't hit a deadline, but my art was good. So I just sort of quit college and started working. But I would have to say that while I used to call myself a comic book artist, these days I'm really not. I'm a director who can draw. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So about 10 years ago, I got into live action directing and just wanted to do it. You know, there's a sort of a story behind that I'll get to that relates to the puppeteering. But because I can draw, and a lot of artists that I know, men and women who do comics, especially when they're really young, it turns out that's a really great training ground for any other artistic discipline. So in my 20s, you know, my friends that I went to high school with, you know, they were pumping gas or whatever it is kids do in their 20s. I was drawing Batgirl. That was my job. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean I'm better or worse than anybody. It just means I got a really early on-the-job training. And so now, 30 years later, like I consult for Microsoft right now doing creative stuff, and I can just sit and I can just draw it. Or like if I'm on set talking to my actors or talking to my DP, I can just sketch. Well, here's kind of what I'm thinking of. And I'm really grateful for the training I got in comics, even though the business was not great, because now it's really helped me in the commercial side and in the entertainment world.
Sure. Sure, absolutely. You know, we gain knowledge through our experiences, whether or not it's something we pursue further.
Yeah.
A couple months ago, we had the creator of How I Met Your Mother, Carter Bays, and we had him on the show, and he was talking about how he got his start writing sketches for like the David Letterman show. And so, you know, you wouldn't really think like, oh, from there you can go on to creating a sitcom.
Sure.
But that's what it is. It's you're doing this thing, you're gaining the knowledge, and then you see where it takes you. You see what the next thing takes you to.
Right.
So I wanna, you know, start at the beginning and kind of and then catch us up. And you gave us a little sneak peek. So you know, from what I read, and this is a direct quote, you are the son of a renowned portrait artist. Is that accurate?
she's renowned or not, but she was quite good.
Okay. I was gonna say, yeah. I'm quoting the article that I read. But that
it might be embellished a little.
Yeah. And that but that you've drawn, like you've been, you know, involved in drawing since practically the time you could hold a pencil. So this is something goes as far back as you can remember almost.
Oh, yeah. I knew I was going to do comics when I was like 5 or 6 years old. That's just what I did. Once it was made clear, once it was made clear that, oh, people make those. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh, well, I'm a person. Maybe I could grow up and make comics. And I just didn't, as I got older, I thought, you know, as I would hone my skills, because I was pretty much ready to be published when I was about 18, 19. Wasn't fast enough. That came much later. But I was reasonably, you know, I could draw reasonably well. I remember thinking, well, I don't have to get a job at McDonald's. I can just show my samples and try to get work and get paid to do that. You know what I mean?
Right.
And so 30 years later, that's kind of what happened.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And guys, I see questions coming in the chats. I promise I'm going to get to them. We're going to lay some foundational work and then we're going to get to your questions. So keep them coming in and we'll get to them. I promise. So as I was reading, by the time you were 16, you were kind of already creating your own like homegrown comic books, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
What are the kind of stories, I'm curious, that a 16-year-old is putting out there in a comic book?
Well, the funny thing is they were just mini comics. I don't even know if I have any anymore. There weren't a ton of them. What I was doing was creating sample comic pages to try to emulate the comics I was reading in an effort to get a job. But the stories I was writing, it's funny, were actually, I can't jinx it because we're so early in the process, but there's a thing I'm going to do, hopefully this next year, that is one of my earliest creations when I was like 12 or 13. It's not going to be a comic book necessarily, and that's all I'm going to say, but it's a real thrill to look at it and go, oh my God, I dreamt that when I was 13 and then sat down and drew it.
So the stories circle.
I came up with in high school, yeah, I was much more into science fiction. I wasn't much into superheroes, and I liked drawing women, so what I wanted to do was become a pinup artist like Vargas or Petty or Olivia or people like that. I draw men, fine, whatever, but I was drawing like sci-fi chicks with swords and laser rifles and things like that. So not a lot of superhero stuff until I started working in the business.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. Right on. And it's important to note for the audience that you didn't go to art school. You're self-taught. You like, this is just a repetitive kind of thing and learn by practice.
I couldn't afford it. I mean, you know, I resolved when I was in high school not to have any student loan debt because I knew I wasn't going to get like a degree. But even going to art school, I mean, it's funny. I got accepted to Parsons. I got accepted to Pratt. I got accepted to the Rhode Island School of Design. But I refused to get any student loans because even back then I knew it was a trap. And I was broke. We were a rather poor family. So I just sort of, in comics, they don't care where you've gone to school. They don't care about your resume. They go, Can you meet a deadline and is your art good? Great, you're hired, you know? So.
Sure. I mean, there's, for those that don't know too, there is history of maybe artists, writers, and all that kind of being taken advantage of because of the position they're in, you know, not being paid appropriately and all. And we can touch on all that too. But,
sure.
You know, and again, you kind of alluded to this, but you had your first big kind of assignment, 1990, you're drawing Star Trek for DC Comics and you're 20 years old. I mean, I can't fathom. I know what I was doing at 20 and I'm like, there's no way I'm drawing Star Trek for DC Comics. Well,
Let me tell you the story. So yeah. I think I'm probably a bit older than you, sadly. Oh. So when the Batman movie came out, what was that, 1989?
Yep. First Batman.
So everybody, you know, he was a Batman was it, and the Bat stuff was everywhere. My college roommate, Tom Simmons, I became his penciler. He inked my work and a lot of other people for a number of years. We both went to college together. I was his roommate. He had a very steady hand, incredible inker. And we sat around going like, well, we should do some samples and see if we can get hired. And we thought, well, everybody's doing Batman. Why don't we sneak under the radar and pick a comic that's really poorly drawn and see if we could do better? And I'm not crapping on the artist who was drawing it. It's just not important who he was.
Sure.
Although he did ink me and it wasn't good. But whatever. It's not his fault. But we looked at the comic and went, well, God, I can do better likenesses than that. And so we're living in Portales in this, you know, one horse town, a little shack. I had quit college by then and I was just doing country music radio. I was a DJ overnights and we would work on our samples. And I just figured, well, maybe if our samples look really good and we get in front of the editor on Star Trek, then maybe we would get hired. And as it turns out, that's sort of what happened. Mm. Although we quit our jobs in Portales. We had found out about the San Diego Comic-Con. This would be 1990, I think, that summer. We quit our jobs. Tommy was working at Domino's. I was working at this radio station. And we drove from Portales across Arizona and Nevada to San Diego and stayed with a friend of a friend and just had our samples with us and just wandered into the Comic-Con like, oh, golly, look at all these people. And actually met an editor at DC, Dale Crane, who's not with us anymore, God rest him. And he was really cool. He looked at my samples and said, here's what you did right. Here's what you did wrong. Here's how you can improve. Go do some more. Well, the problem is Tommy and I had no place to live, and we didn't have a job. We had his truck. So we drove back to New Mexico. We hadn't been hired. I didn't have any money, and we ended up staying with an old buddy of mine, a buddy of his, actually. I think he was sort of like family friend of Tommy, Dr. Jeff Wilson. And he was a chiropractor in Tucumcari, New Mexico, which is even smaller than Portales, a little wide spot in the road. And Jeff said, as long as you guys are working on your comic book samples 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. every day, you can live with me rent-free. And so we did that, but we were only there for about 3 months. So it worked out.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, that is such an amazing story because, you know, the idea of like, well, this is what I want to do.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to do it. Like, I don't think a lot of people have that nowadays where like, I'm willing to just drive. Like I can't imagine, you know, 20-year-old really? Me picking up and driving to California and going like, let's see what happens. You know,
we were both heavy metal meatheads then as now. We had a lot more hair then than we do now. And so, you know, we're like blasting Megadeth and Slayer and Pantera and whatnot. And we just didn't want to get real jobs. I didn't want to get a 9-to-5 and have some dick with a tie tell me, you know, put that box over there. I just didn't want to do it. And that's probably hubris on my part and not really being aware of how the world works. But I mean, I did have one 9-to-5 job many, many years ago for about 6 months. I worked at a service bureau and I got trained in like Photoshop and Illustrator. And I'm actually very grateful for the experience. But at the time, the comics market had bottomed out. My career was over. I was getting paid $12 an hour to commute for an hour, to have to get up at 6 a.m. to go to this place I didn't want to be. And I remember looking at my reflection in the glass in the train, because I took the train out there going, man, people used to ask for your autograph. You used to be a star. Because they really treated us like rock stars in the 90s.
Sure.
So, but it was a good learning experience. But other than that, I have just been freelance. And I keep my overhead low, but I just wanted to be an artist. I just didn't want to, like, you know, drive a bus. Or I'm not demeaning anybody who has any like a job like that. I wouldn't survive. I would get fired. You know what I mean? I have two skills, drawing and complaining. That's it.
I don't think there's anything wrong with the idea of knowing, like, I know what I'm meant to do, or maybe I know what I'm not meant to do. So I need to find something else. You know, like, I know I'm not meant to do a desk job. It's not going to work for me.
I'm not sure it's, I hear what you're saying. I'm not sure it's meant to be as much as I just didn't want to do it. So that's probably really just spoiled, you know, Brad and me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's all it was. I didn't know what I couldn't do or wasn't supposed to do. It's just ignorance on my part. That's all it is.
Yeah.
I didn't believe I had some destiny or anything like that.
it was in the car. Well, I mean, because from an outside, okay, now take an outsider's perspective, right?
Yeah.
From me hearing, at 5 years old, 6 years, I knew what I wanted to do. And then, you know, at 20 or 18, 19, 20, I'm going to drive out there. I'm going to get it done. It sounds like destiny. It was meant to be. It was in the cards for you.
We had a good time.
You know,
there's been some starving. It's not like I'm rich or anything. There's definitely been some starving artist shit. So,
I mean, can you call yourself an artist if you're not starving at some point? I mean, really?
Probably, yeah. I mean, thankfully not anymore. Or not for a while, but there was some back in the day because I'm not the fastest comic book artist in the world. I was trained to be a penciler. And so people like Tommy would ink, would sort of draw and embellish over my pencils. He was brilliant. God, I miss working with him. He was just amazing.
So,
but I had to learn to ink and color and do all that stuff on my own. And it was just sort of over. And I'm still not that great of an inker. But I had to sort of pick up skills as I went. And then when I left the comics business behind, I discovered that the fact that I had done comics like month after month, I wasn't that fast. And I got into the digital art world, I was way faster. And then suddenly I was able to make a lot more money.
right. Oh, and we're going to, you jump in the script on me. Cause I want to ask all these questions. But to level set for the audience, can you give us a quick explanation? What's the difference of the penciler, the inker, the colorist, that guy?
Well, it starts with an editor who's foolish enough to pick up the phone and call me. Because I blew a lot of deadlines. just very slow. Every elbow I drew had to be the greatest elbow ever drawn. No one's going to care. You know, the writer writes the script, and a lot of comic writers want to be, particularly television writers, so they'll write too much dialogue. But then I'll take their script, and as the penciler, I've got to turn their words into visual storytelling. Most comic book pencilers, you know, we've been drawing ever since we were kids, and we love movies in particular. We're movie fanatics. I still, to this day, always have movies playing, like, you know, John Carpenter films, Escape from New York or something awesome, while I'm working. And so after a long time, you just sort of pick up movie storytelling, visual storytelling kind of through osmosis. And I noticed, and there was some education. I had some mentors. I didn't go to school or anything, but I had some mentors who would, you know, I'd send my pencils to them and they'd kind of tell me, here's what you did wrong. But you sort of pick up the visual storytelling. The difficulty for me was that I'm really slow when I draw by hand, because I felt like every hair had to be in the right place and whatnot. And as I did comics, I did it for full time, for 10 years of my 20s, full time. My penciling loosened up because I started to really enjoy watching different inkers apply. What they do is they take brushes and pens and they apply India ink, which is supposed to be waterproof, right on top of the paper, right on top of my pencils. So once I've done my pencils and it's inked, my pencils don't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. So I always take photocopies of my pencils. I have a complete record of my career. But my pencils got looser and I started thinking, well, I wonder if I could ink. Well, my hands aren't very steady. Someone like Tommy he was like the Terminator, man, just glacially steady hand, beautiful razor sharp lines. God, he was incredible. So then when the inks are done, this is before the digital age, the art pages are about 11 by 17 inches. They put them under a stat camera and shoot a negative of the art and then create sort of a half-sized version of the art they would give to a colorist who would use Dr. Martin's dyes, or basically watercolors straight out of the bottle, and paint just like a coloring book, the different colors, to tell the printer what plate was going to go where, and then go call outs for, you know, cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. The letterer would then take those pages. Actually, it's before the colors, but then the letterer would write on the paper. You'd try to leave room in the comic panels, and they would draw the word balloon and draw the lettering. And I am the worst letterer on earth. That is such a specific skill, you know what I mean? Then when that's done, it's sent off to the printer. They print the plates, they print the pages, and then if we were lucky, we would get a Dialux back, which is just sort of a small half-size comic book where you can check it for, like, you know, tears in the film or hairs or things like that. And that's pretty much it.
Wow. So, yeah, so that for because, you know, the layman goes, oh, there's a guy that draws it, and maybe there's a guy that writes it. Yeah. And like, but it's a team of people. It is a team.
Well, not anymore.
Well,
not anymore, but it was
classically.
I have to say that I'm really grateful that I got that training. I was one of the last generation to work in the pre-digital era, where it was paste up and Zip-A-Tone and whiteout and razor blades and the whole thing. And so when I started working in, like, Photoshop, especially, it was just a digital version of airbrushing or of drawing, because you can just create a mask and you just, there's no physical paper. But the whole reason I started the TikTok thing was to draw on paper, because I don't want to lose the ability to just sit down with a sketch pad and just draw something. When I'm 90 years old, I want to still be able to draw a pretty good human figure. You know what I mean? Just with a ballpoint pen.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So, okay. So real quick, because I want to touch on some of the audience questions. Okay. These are always a little bit random. So let's see. First one. What is possibly your top favorite good or evil characters to draw?
Good, oh boy. I mean, I love Spider-Man. I've always loved Spider-Man. He has to have the underarm webbing or it doesn't look right. You know, the 1960s John Romita Sr. Spider-Man.
Oh, yeah.
I drew the Hulk. Excuse me. I drew the Hulk in the Defenders miniseries called The Order. It was my first Marvel gig. And I got to draw the Hulk, like, throwing tanks around and, you know, bashing plays out of the air. And that was fun. I'm very much a Marvel zombie. Most of my output was for DC, and they've been very good to me, but I'm a hardcore. All I wanted to do when I was a kid was draw Spider-Man and the X-Men. That's all I cared about.
Nice.
But I didn't have the style they wanted at the time. So.
Yeah, very cool. The villain
has got to be – that's a brain teaser. I got to get back to you on that one.
Yeah, you do a pretty maniacal Joker, I got to say. The kind of Joker that you look at and it's just like, ooh, like it.
Well, thank you. Everybody draws the Joker, and I like the idea of drawing somebody who's really weird and out there. Honestly, you know what? For that Gotham motion comics that we did to promote the show on Fox, drawing the guy who was playing the Penguin, man, he was great. And I never gave a crap about the Penguin when I was young. I thought he was a really dumb villain. They really figured out how to do it in that show, and I had a great time drawing him.
Very cool. Very cool. Okay, another question. Captain Wayne says, what would you first suggest for new drawing artists? So I guess artists drawing, getting in that field of maybe a comic book art or, yeah, just new aspiring artists, I guess.
Well, that's kind of a broad question. I'm not sure what you mean. Do you mean advice on drawing or...
Yeah, it's a vague question there, Captain Wayne. Let's say maybe wanting to get into the field of drawing and comics. Let's go with that.
All right. Well, the first thing I would say, don't just draw anime because everybody for the past 20 years, they're all drawing one piece in anime. Look, I love anime. That's great. But it all looks the same after a while. They cannot separate themselves from other anime artists, and you're not going to get hired. You're just not going to get a job. So what I tell people, whether, you know, kids or adults, a lot of them, there's like adults who are in their 30s and 40s who suddenly decided I'm going to be a comic artist. I'm like, man, that's great. And here's what you need to do. Take life drawing. Or if you can't, you know, especially with COVID and whatnot, it's probably hard to do right now, but just take a sketchbook, even a moleskin notebook. I love moleskins because they're small, but they have really great paper. And take just a stupid ballpoint pen or a pencil and go sit outside and just draw people. Draw hands. Take a week and just draw hands. Just draw feet. Just draw ears. Just draw dogs. It doesn't matter. Just draw. And I can certainly give you some resources. In fact, I should post them on my website about anatomy books, but I really don't use a lot of those. The way you learn to draw is by drawing. Hmm. And what I tell these people is just draw every single day, even when you don't feel like it. I just put in a 10-hour day today because that's what I do, even though I'm sick. But you got to draw even when you don't feel like it, especially when you don't feel like it, because that's what separates the professional from the amateur.
Sure. And, you know, sometimes a job is a job. You go, I don't want to draw Transformers fighting Power Rangers, but that's the job, you know.
People talk about inspiration when it comes to art, and I don't believe in it. I believe in discipline. You know, you make yourself sit down and draw, and then the inspiration comes from the fact that you're sitting there drawing, and I end up having a great time.
Yeah. There you go. Let's see. One last question from the chat. It's from Heath. What is, in your opinion, what is Marvel's best comic? That's a tough one.
I don't, okay.
I guess your favorite.
What's that?
I guess your favorite.
My favorite. Yeah, I'm going back a ways because, again, Marvel was all I gave a crap about in high school. I didn't just go to the comic store. I subscribed to the X-Men, New Mutants, Excalibur, and I want to say one of the Spider-Man, like Web of Spider-Man. So they would mail those things to my house. And my stepmother would, I'd run to the mailbox. It comes like a brown wrapper. She's like, oh, is he ordering porn? I'm like, no, it's comic books, man. So all I gave a crap about was especially the X-Men when I was in high school, because Chris Claremont was writing it, Paul Smith, and then John Romita Jr., Dan Green, and then I think Alan Davis for a while was drawing it. But as far as the best comic, the best single issue, it's boy, I got to say X-Men 173. It's got to be 81, 82. The cover is really iconic. It's Wolverine in a brown costume and Rogue, a very early Rogue in a green costume on a black background that's running toward the camera. And Smitty, I've gotten to know Smitty in the intervening years, but he was one of my favorite songs in high school because his drawing looked like, it looked like pop art. It didn't even look like comic art. So 173, they go to Tokyo and they meet like the Silver Samurai or something. The story doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but it's gorgeous. It's a masterclass in storytelling. It's how you do a comics, X-Men 173. The other one, for me, would have to be, and it's not one issue, but it's a collected trade paperback called Daredevil Born Again, which they used as the template for the Daredevil TV series, I think the first and second season.
Sure.
So that's Frank Miller, before he lost his mind. Dave Mazzucchelli, who's one of the greatest comic artists who ever lived. And they really ground Daredevil. I mean, he can't fly. He just has fast reflexes and has heightened, you know, radar sense because he's blind, and that's it. But they do this incredible thing, like probably one of my favorite pages in any comic I've ever read is in one of the issues of the Born Again arc, which is four or five issues. Daredevil's fighting a guy, but he can't take him down. And then suddenly he's hit by Cap's shield, and then Captain America's standing there, and he's already holding an injured person, and he yells up at Thor and says, put those flames out. We don't want a gas man going up. And when we see Thor, he's just a silhouette. And so the sort of like superhero powered stuff in Daredevil, we didn't really see. They treated Thor like a force of nature, like a hurricane. He's just a silhouette. And the caption says, suddenly it's raining so hard it hurts. And then Iron Man is standing there with his handout saying, you know, that man is ours, that federal authority, back away. But the best panel I've ever seen in my entire life is something that your audience might really get something out of. I love Captain America. because he's not about worshiping any particular political leader. He's about worshiping the dream of America, the dream of freedom, which is why I really love him. And there's a panel where the villain that Daredevil is fighting has got the American flag painted on his face. And Cap says he wears the flag. Daredevil says, I hadn't noticed, and takes off. And it's a silhouette. I got to email it to you, dude. You got to see this to show it to your audience. It's just a silhouette of Captain America. And the caption says, it doesn't mean anything to them, thinks the soldier. To them, it's just a piece of cloth. Sometimes I feel so weak. And I get choked up just thinking about that. It's just a silhouette, but it encapsulates who he is and why he does what he does. He doesn't do it for credit. He doesn't do it for fame. He doesn't do it for money. He just loves the American dream specifically.
Wow.
Right? I'll send you that panel, man. You
absolutely. I got goosebumps. I got goosebumps, right? Man. You're telling me, walking me through it. I love it. I love it.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I good stuff. I feel like I want to take like a moment of silence. Like, that was such a great answer that I feel like I just want to let it sit for a second.
I'll send you the image so you can share it. Absolutely. You got to see it.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, absolutely. Here's the thing. I have a faint memory of that image. So I'm curious. Yeah, I'm curious. I want to see it. I'll even Google it. But yes, if you have, I definitely, yes, because that's. Yeah. We're going to put that up.
So that's probably my favorite like arc that I've ever seen done. But again, I was reading Marvel hardcore when I was 12 or 13. I actually quit reading comics full time when I started drawing them, because then I was at DC. And then I ended up at Dark Horse Comics for a few years. I was their artist in residence. And I sort of was reading a lot of independent comics because they were doing some really daring, wild stuff.
Sure.
And into the night. So as far as like, recent Marvel comics, man, I couldn't tell you.
Yeah, no, that's a.
I mean, for DC, there's like Killing Joke and Watchmen and Dark Knight, all the classics. As far as recent stuff, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, no, those great answers. Great answers. And our audience is probably older than you think, so you're hitting the nostalgia right on the head. So it's perfect.
Oh, good.
In fact, yeah, we're getting comments like, "Wow, I like how passionate this guy is." Like you're hitting the nerve.
A big deal to me, man.
Yeah, of course. It's. For a guy like me, it's like the fabric of who I am. I've got tattoos of my favorite comic book characters. So,
Problem is the business sucks, but yeah. I'm passionate about the art form. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure. For sure. Unfortunately, sometimes doing what I do and getting to talk to people and talking behind the scenes, you start to see, some of the luster fades, start to see. Some of the ugly side of it.
I mean, what the industry depends on is finding young kids like me and a lot of my pals who are like 19, 20 years old who've got talent and then chewing them up and spitting them out because they can pay us a pittance. So, and there's always some hungry artist right behind us who thinks they're going to be famous. Or really what it is they're like, wow, I get to draw Batman. Yeah, I got to draw Batman. Cool. Then what? Does that pay the bills? So it sucks, but I mean, I still love my time in comics. I would still do comics if I could do my own comic on my own terms, but it would take a while to come out because I'm kind of slow.
Yeah, yeah. And that was actually kind of the next thing I was going to talk about is because, I have it that, like we said, you worked on the Star Trek comic. You worked on Batgirl, Superman, Birds of Prey, Defenders. You got to work on this, but for those that don't know, especially when it was like you said, the Amazing Spider-Man, where it is a monthly, if not bi-monthly release, like you have to draw at lightning speeds to keep up.
Yes and no. So again, since I don't, most comic artists that I know don't have any formal training. There are a few, but like Jim Lee, for example, I think Jim had like a degree in mathematics or something, or physics or something, and then he, when he was like 19 or 20, don't ever play poker against Jim Lee. He will rob you blind. He's a gifted telepathic poker player. But he just sort of started doing it. Or J. Scott Campbell, who started working for Wildstorm and then ended up creating, I think, Gen 13. Some of your fans might remember that. And a lot of artists like that who were self-taught, once they're thrown in off the deep end, it's really sink or swim. And J. Scott Campbell in particular got super good in about a year and a half. Travis Charest, who I want to say is French, I don't know, was another example of like his art was kind of weird. The eyes were set way too far apart when he first started penciling. And then like a year or two later, he was just a god. So a lot of artists in the 70s like Walt Simonson or Jim Aparo or Bill Sienkiewicz, when Billy first started working, they all kind of drew like Neil Adams because that was one of the big deal artists in the 70s. But after a year or two, they sort of started finding their own way. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Barry Windsor Smith was drawing Conan, and the art was sort of eh. And then a year or two later, he was like a rock star. He just, something clicked in his brain, and he was doing work that, like, nobody could even touch. You know what I mean? I don't know how fast or slow he was. So the reason for all that is that because I'm self-taught, I had to kind of come up with a visual language to be able to draw not just well, but consistently well. The difficulties that my style is kind of naturalistic. I didn't have a visual language like Jim Lee or Jim Aparo, who could sort of like, and here's my Batman, or here's my Wonder, here's what a guy looks like, here's what a girl looks like, here's what a car looks like. I kept trying to make it really authentic. Like, for example, a lot of the Batman comics were Birds of Prey. My dad taught me about guns, taught me to shoot. I'm a lousy shot. He's an expert. But I wanted to make sure the guns looked real,
right?
Because it brought you into the story. The comic I drew at Dark Horse was called Ghost. It was sort of a female version of that pulp hero, The Shadow, with two .45 caliber pistols. So I got a little, I found that at like a swap meet, a little golden, perfect version of a 1911 pistol. And I would just hold it up to my eye while I was drawing and would just pet because I wanted the guns to look correct. I saw so many artists, it was probably just their deadlines, but who didn't seem to want to put any effort into making it look dangerous. I mean, these heroes are facing people with guns and whatnot. Make it look real. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, instead of just a square block that has a hole on it. Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to put some effort into it, but it just meant that I was really slow.
Yeah, yeah. Awesome. And you know, we're already running short on time, and there's so much I want to ask you, and I definitely want to get into, obviously, some of your later stuff with directing and the producing and the writing and everything. But just general quick question. I want to know, what is the feeling that first time, you know, you see your name on the cover of a comic, right? You see the writer's name, you see the inker, and like, what was that feeling for you in that moment the first time seeing it?
Well, you know, we used to joke about that. I was in a studio for a while with guys like Carl Kiesel and Terry Dodson and Matthew Clark, Tommy, and some other folks. And we all used to joke, like, once we see our comics in a 7-Eleven on the spinner rack, that's when we've made it. And I remember thinking, well, maybe we should aim a little higher, fellas, you know. But it's a cool feeling, but I have to admit, it wasn't as – it was great. Don't get me wrong. Even though I had blown – like, when I saw Star Trek and my name was on this 54-page annual – but I had blown the deadline by like 4 months and almost got fired. And so it was a lot of mixed emotions. It wasn't as cool as seeing my name on a director's slate the very first time I directed something.
Gotcha.
That's like being a rock star. That's like being on stage, ripping out a guitar solo. It's better than sex. I felt like I left my body. So, but there is a similar feeling when you work. I think what it is that when you work on a comic book, you know, most of the stuff I've done were like 54-page annuals, 80-page annuals, you know, large graphic novels that took like a year to do. So I've been living with it for so long that when it comes out, I'm just more relieved that I don't have to draw it anymore.
Gotcha.
That makes sense?
Yeah, it's a release. It's like,
it's still cool, but it's a
done. Yeah, gotcha. And you know, you got into digital artwork, which kind of led you to doing, you know, artwork for video game companies. You know, you did stuff for Ubisoft and Atari and Sony and film and television. I mean, what attracted you to that, the kind of the digital side of it? Was it the efficiency of it, being able to produce it faster?
Honestly, so I've been doing digital art for over 20 years, for pretty much full time. When the Candy iMac came out, I don't know. I don't think it's because I had that job. Before I got that job and got trained in Illustrator, I don't remember the story, but I somehow saw the writing on the wall and went, I better get into digital art now. It was like 1999, so I bought an iMac, the first little Wacom tablet, a scanner, which I still have, it still works, and a copy of like Photoshop. And I just stayed up for like a weekend, didn't sleep, was just like, oh my God, I can color my own work, this is amazing. And just something told me that I better get in front of that or I was going to get left behind, you know what I mean? So, and then when I had that 9-to-5 job for 6 months, I got trained in Photoshop and I got trained in Illustrator, the vector drawing program. So when the company went under and I went back into doing comics and then inadvertently ended up at like LucasArts and Ubisoft and whatnot, I would tell them, well, by the way, I'm trained in Photoshop. I'm also trained in Illustrator. That made me really competitive because I could do both programs. Most people only do one or the other. So I'm glad I did it. You know what I mean? And now I don't even think about it. I've been doing it for so long.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. I mean, yeah, that's incredible. Somebody was trying to call in to say hi. So, just so you know, but sorry guys, we don't take live callers when we have the guest on because we try to keep the show flowing and you never know what people say when they answer the phone. So especially our audience. So I do want to, you got to do something that I loved so much was watching, Who Wants to Be a Superhero. And it was it was this small thing. It wasn't the
you watched the show?
Absolutely. Every episode when it aired, I grew up a big Stan Lee fan, obviously. I adore Stan Lee, he's the best. but the idea of like getting to bring to life a normal person to be a hero, like, oh, I loved the idea of it. It was like two seasons long. I mean, there I know there's a great story that I heard on how you I would love can you tell us that story? How you landed that job?
I'll make it really quick. So what got me into doing video game art was Craigslist. I had read an article in the LA Times. I was not even living in LA at the time, and discovered Craigslist and discovered job postings. That's how it was what got me into Ubisoft. So I suddenly was doing video game art. So then I became obsessed with finding jobs on Craigslist. And one day they were putting together the shoot for the pilot. They were trying to sell the show, Who Wants to Be a Superhero? And I saw a casting notice in LA. And I thought, well, they're probably going to need comic book art for this show. Why don't I get in touch? So I sent them an email. Hey, here's my first horrible little website. Give me a call. An hour later, I get this panicked phone call from the producer. Oh my God, this is serendipity. How soon can you be here? I'm like, well, I'm up in Portland. We'll get you a plane ticket. Don't even worry about it. And then he said, like, do we have to, you know, because people who don't do art, they don't really quite understand it unless they see it. He said, do we have to, you know, mount a camera over your panels? Like, no, I'll bring my laptop. It's all digital. Oh, thank God. You know, so I was able to get jobs like that because I could just put my office fit in a bag, get on a plane and go. Yeah. So we did the pilot. And then I thought, okay, we're going to sell. It was going to be at MTV at the time. I thought, oh, this is fantastic. I met Stan. And my TV career's taken off. And I had to fight for my job on both seasons. I had to come down to LA, go to Nash, the company that owned it, go in the office. Like, my art is what sold the show. What's the matter with you? But they did end up hiring me, and I got to do both seasons. And we got to do a bunch of charity stuff. And that led to a freelance relationship with Stan and his company for like 12, 13 years off and on.
I was very fortunate to meet Stan three times throughout my life. And he was the nicest, sweetest guy. I mean, any amazing Stan Lee stories that you can share that just show how awesome he was, because he was always the best.
You know, I always say that he was a very sweet man who always paid for lunch. I did a gig once to the NHL, where they had turned, because, you know, Stan's brief was, we're going to take plumbers and we're going to turn them into superheroes. That was just his business model. So for the NHL, we were going to take all of the mascots and turn them into superheroes, the Blackhawks and whatever. And so there were a bunch of artists working on it. I did four comics. I didn't really care. I'm not the biggest hockey guy. It was a job, whatever. And I just wasn't really putting my best foot forward. I was doing it all digital and just trying to get out of the job and get paid and move on, even though I'd already worked for Stan like half a dozen times. I get a phone call. Stan never called me before or since, but he calls me at like 10 o'clock at night. Now, Matt, I understand. I've been looking at your art, and I just don't think this isn't the best art that I know you're capable of. So we're going to take some time. We're going to go over each and every panel and each and every line, and I'm going to tell you what you did wrong, and I want you to fix it, because if you don't fix it, and he didn't say anything like you're not going to get paid. He said, I'm going to be very, very disappointed in you. And I went, oh, no, I can't live with that. So for 4.5 hours, I'm on the phone with Stan. Yes, Mr. Lee. Yes, absolutely, Mr. Lee. I went back and I redrew all four stories. And, of course, it was the year they had a work stoppage with hockey, so I don't even know if that thing ever came out. But at least when I met him the following year and I went to his office, oh, I remember that. You listened to me and you did a much better job. You should be proud of yourself. So that's my Stan Lee story. I mean, everybody who worked for Stan, we all have a bad Stan Lee impression, all of us.
I mean, oh man, that's what an awesome experience.
I learned a lot.
For you, I can't imagine, you know, somebody who grew up reading comics, and, you know, obviously Stan Lee has a big place in comic Marvel history.
Absolutely.
I mean, the brain that birthed the Marvel universe, pretty much.
Well, I mean, a lot of the artists, you know, the problem is when I started working for Stan, I already had kind of a chip on my shoulder, because I believe it was the artists like Jack Kirby and Steve Ditko that really created the Marvel universe, John Buscema especially. Right. So I felt like Stan, you know, I don't want to get into that stuff. I love Stan. He was always very nice to me, but, you know, I wish I'd met some of those cats. I never got to meet any of the classic artists.
Sure, sure.
But I got to meet Stan, and he did. He taught me a ton, so I will always be grateful to him.
Yeah, and it's one of those, right? It's one of those things of going, okay, let's take a sitcom. It's like, well, I'm the writer. I put the words out there. Well, I'm the actor, and I brought the character to life. Well, I'm the director, and I put it together. And So it's right. like, who really, I mean, it's a team effort. It's a team effort.
Well, I'll tell you who really does it is the editor.
There you go. He puts it all together, right?
The editor is the unsung hero of comics and of film and TV.
You heard it here first. You heard it here first. Right. Well, since we're running, man, so low on time, I really wanted to dive into too, and maybe we'll do a part two sometime. But okay. all the directing work you've done and all the, like, what made you switch kind of tracks, and move into kind of the visual medium and TV and film?
It's a longer story that we probably don't have time for, but suffice it to say that a number of people died around me in very short succession. Every 2 or 3 months, I was going to a funeral. This has got to be 15 years ago. And I remember having a panic attack in my office. It's while I was working, I think, on the second season of Superhero, where I thought, oh, my God, I'm going to be next. Because I was constantly going to funerals, and all my good friends were dying. And it was really weird. And then my little brother passed on. And I just panicked and went, well, if I'm going to die tomorrow, I better do what it is I really want to do. And so I put together what little money I had, found a crew up in Portland, and just shot a demo for a feature we were going to do, which ended up not happening. But I got bit by the bug. And especially because I can sit down and I can, you know, sort of draw. I'm not a professional storyboard artist, but I can draw shooting boards. And then I got a ton of training with an incredible woman named Judith Weston, who's been training me for over a decade on how to work with actors. So I just got bit by the bug, man. And I mean, the more I do it, you know, I directed a pilot right before COVID, right before the lockdown happened. Mm-hmm. So I came back from the shoot, and I had hard drives full of footage. And I was like, well, I guess I'll just cut this myself. So I spent 6 weeks as happy as a pig in a wallet thinking, well, the world's going to end, but I get to edit my show together. So I try to do it as often as I can. Like I say, I'm really hoping we get to do this thing this next year. I don't want to jinx it, but, you know, stay sure. tuned.
Yeah, no, and you got to come back and promote it when it happens, because, sure. you know, sure. we're going to do it. Yeah, so and real quick, because there's so much that I wanted to dive into and we didn't get to, but, like, you know, people do have to check out your website. You know, you offer up commissions. I'm just curious, is it a way to... keep yourself creatively creating things?
I'm not. It's funny you bring that up. I can't accept commissions anymore. I'm book solid for a year. And so I did that experiment on TikTok just because I kind of wanted to. But sadly, I won't be able to accept commissions for quite some time. Right. So people that got them, they got them. But I did it, like I said, because I just don't want to lose my facility with drawing on paper. And that's really the focus of comic books is can you sit down and write a script, or can you sit down and just draw Spider-Man swinging across the rooftops on a piece of paper. That's really all it is. I just love to draw.
Yeah. And speaking of your TikTok, I know you reined it back a bit, but to point out that, you know, your first video gets, is it 2.6 million views?
That's so ridiculous, man.
Doodling Batman, right?
I hate TikTok. I hate the whole idea of TikTok, but I did it because I felt like, all right, whatever. It was an experiment. So I didn't really take it seriously, and people have been surprisingly nice. And so I offered some commissions just because I thought I haven't done a comic since Wonder Woman 77. And then I gave up on the TikTok because I just got stupid busy. I'm triple booked. So it's like, I don't have time to put into it anymore, which sucks, but there's nothing I can do about it. Yeah. So it was a fun experiment.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, hopefully you get, I mean, that's how I came across your work. And hopefully you get back into it, because there are so many people out there that need to be, introduced to this world, right? The art world.
I might, for the project that we're hoping to do this next year, I might start posting stuff from that on the TikTok just because it's there.
Yeah.
But, you know, my numbers started, people started leaving because I wasn't posting twice a day or doing the cinnamon challenge or whatever the hell it is you're supposed to do. So
yeah.
I wasn't really taking it seriously, but people were really nice.
Yeah. No, I'm a big fan. I agree that there are sides of TikTok that I think are just a waste of human brain cells.
Yeah.
But, like, I love, like, the educational stuff, the did you knows, sure. the do it yourselves. And again, the art, I'm on the art side of it, where I love watching the creation of things. And so that it's phenomenal. But, so where can people support you? Where can people follow you? Where can people see what you're up to?
Well, I don't have anything to pimp. Like I said, I'm just up to my neck, and I'm very grateful to be doing the stuff I'm doing, but it's not, none of it I can talk about, sadly. So the best place to find me is I post on Instagram as often as I can at Matt Haley Art. I believe my TikTok is Matt Haley Art as well. I don't actually remember. Or my site is just matthaley.com. I need to finally work with my assistant who keeps telling me she should take over my PR. I should let her do that. But I don't really have anything to promote right now. So it's really more like, here's the stuff I've done. stay tuned. You know, probably Instagram is the best place.
Sure, sure. Well, no, we're definitely gonna follow you. You'll see me creeping there now because I like to follow my guests, see what they are, and also because I'll be able to be like, hey, remember that guy we had on like 3 weeks ago? Like he's doing this thing, and
yeah exactly.
You know, we exactly. we become yeah, a family.
Instagram's fun because I can see other artists. I find it really inspiring. It's really great for art.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, I like I said, I'm so appreciative of your time. I know you're not feeling well. Sure.
That's
so,
okay.
So for you to take the time to be here on the show, this has been so much fun, and hopefully, you know, is there anywhere? Because I'm curious, because I know you posted up some artwork. Is there anywhere people can buy prints or anything like that? Or are there well, anything like that out there?
Yeah, I'm probably gonna build a new store. It's just like I say, the I don't know how to put this. Everything really blew up in my career about 2 or 3 weeks ago, and suddenly things are very different than they were, like, for example, when I first started TikTok. And so, yeah, I'm probably going to do that. I don't know when. The best thing to do is to find me on Instagram.
There you go.
Or TikTok. Yeah, but really, Instagram, I post more, and that's where there'll be some news, or there'll be probably an update on the site, just matthaley.com.
Fantastic. All right, guys, you heard it here, matthaley.com. You know where to say, keep an eye out because things, fingers crossed, are coming, and we're gonna support.
We're gonna
support. We're gonna show up, and hopefully we'll have you back, and we can actually dive into those things and
stay in touch.
You know, we'll catch the second half of your career versus, you know, focusing so much on the first half, but we really got into it.
The first half was
more interesting. Well, no, you've been an open book, and I really appreciate it. And you know, the fans, they're saying thank you, and you know, it was very insightful conversation.
Great.
Let me, I'll give you the last 3 seconds here to you know, say goodbye to the audience, and then we'll toss it to a break.
I don't know. Merry Christmas, everybody. Let's stay safe out there.
Outstanding. All right, guys, this is Matt Haley. We're going to throw it to a short break. We'll be right back with more after this.
Smoke broken into a the voice of U.S. Army, WTF Moments. This is WTF Nation Radio.
Hey guys, welcome back, welcome back, welcome back. Hey, it's your boy CQ. This is Pop Culture Warrior, and that was Matt Haley on the phone with us, ladies and gentlemen. What a phenomenal guy. Let's bring back Mr. Radar, everybody. Hey, say hi, Radar.
Hi, Radar.
Every time you do that, I feel like when you go off screen, you can't breathe. So, like, when you come back, you're just like...
That's literally what happens. I don't breathe all week. I only breathe for the 2 hours I'm on the show. And,
Oh, man, that's too good. But that was Matt Haley, man. What'd you think?
That was good. It was good shit. It was... I wouldn't say good shit. I feel bad. He's like, you know... I feel like... When he's like, yeah, come, I want my dad to hear this. And I'm like, oh, great. He's going to hear the first hour of me being an idiot.
Yeah, yeah. So, okay. So just because you're mentioning something the audience didn't hear, which was.
I forgot. I'm not going to say it.
As we were talking, as we were saying goodbye, he's like, hey, man, can I get a link to this? Which I said, Mom, Spanky, somebody will send him a link to the, you know, kind of archival footage of this. And because he said. His dad likes to listen and hear him do these things. So I was like, that's sweet.
That's really cool.
It's a sweet moment.
You know what? My dad doesn't listen to this show either. So.
He said it to your dad. He's like, what the fuck? I don't watch this shit.
I don't know. I mean, in all fairness, it's not a problem. No, I'm just kidding. No, yeah. I'm so stoked. It's awesome like that his dad like. Yeah. Wants to be part of it and like follows him and is still like
he's still proud of it. Proud of his boy. Cool. Wants still... to hear what he's doing. That's
and
cool.
He's doing so much. It's awesome. It's really cool.
Yeah. That was a fun interview, man. He's a cool dude. I man, what a trooper. Like as soon as we like as I got him on the phone and he's like, listen, do you mind if I don't put my camera on because I'm sitting in the dark and I've got 103 fever and I feel like crap. And I'm like, why are you doing this interview? Just like,
yeah, right.
I told him, I was like, let's just, it's cool, man. Like, I don't mind. Like, I don't feel bad. Like you're sick. I don't want to, like, I don't want to be interviewed when I'm sick, but, he's true. But he said,
if I was running a 103 fever, Radar would be on his couch right now. Not on the radio.
Right. And so, he said he put in a 10-hour work day today.
I know. It's crazy.
Like that's insane.
I don't even do that.
Insanity.
I put in a 9-hour workday and I'm almost late to get in here for the show.
And you don't even want to be here.
No, I do. I love being here. I really do love being here. I didn't want to be here, somebody else would do it. I'd be like, oh, boss, yeah, I don't want to do it anymore. So I run home, don't even taste my dinner, and then I'm here.
Scott, that's a great point. He said, have you thought maybe doing the interview and talking about passionate things, maybe it cheered him up? And I do feel like he like the energy picked up like throughout the interview, like, you know, he was kind of like trying to get through it. And then, you know, as we were talking about comics and music and all the different things, like it definitely felt like, yeah, Scott, that's a good point. You know, that, the energy kind of, changed a bit through the interview and, well, hopefully he feels better and he recovers.
Absolutely.
And, you know, we were saying, best, you know, when he has some things to promote, man, we'll come back on the show and we're going to be like, yeah, I knew you when, you know, like, he's like, I'm blowing up now. Like, yeah, I knew you back when.
Well, it's cool too. Like, and it's not just him. It's a lot of our guests are coming on and they've got all these things coming down the pipe and it's nice to be able to talk to them and hang out and everyone's busy.
Yeah.
You know, now it's post COVID and everyone's, you know, everyone's back to work and they're trying to catch up on things. And and so it's nice that people are taking their time out of their day. You know, like Tom Holland's coming on in a couple weeks. He's going to, no, I'm just kidding.
No, Radar, this is spoilers.
No spoilers.
I'd rather talk to Andrew Garfield, to be honest.
Okay, we'll talk to whoever. Just maybe we get all three of them at the same time.
I met Andrew Garfield once. He was
Did you?
Lovely. Lovely man. Lovely man. And I'm such a nerd that the first thing I did was pull up my shirt and go, I got a Spider-Man tattoo.
Like such... Spider-Man tattoo. And he's like, wow, they let the special kids get tattoos. That's awesome.
I I'll show you the pictures one. I'll show you the pictures one day because I literally, there's pictures of me, like, because it was like, hey, can we take a picture? And he's like, yeah, sure, no problem. So we take a picture, and then I'm like, can I show you my Spider-Man tattoo? And so he has pictures where he's looking down. It, and at first, it looks like kind of like oh, that's sad. Like, kind of this face. But the other thing is, like, he has his arm around me, and then, like, he's touching my tattoo, which
that sounds creepy.
It's such a weird thing to say out loud, but it was such a cool moment because he's like, whoa, that's awesome. And he's like touching my tattoo, and somebody took a picture at that moment. So, like, this is weird.
Wait, hold on a minute, because these can be interpreted different ways. He's sure. Like, wow, that's awesome. He's like, wow, that's awesome. Like, because it's the same words.
I think the picture should stand for itself. Well, I
wonder how much he gets that kind of thing.
I'm sure quite a bit. I'm sure quite a bit.
He's a pretty accomplished actor even without Spider-Man.
Without a doubt.
He's a very talented actor as well.
Without a doubt. He's an incredibly accomplished actor.
Yeah.
Here, hold on. I think I have.
Do you still have his email? You can. When I dress up as Spider-Man, I dress up as your Spider-Man. Just tell him that.
sorry. I just saw the picture and it made me giggle. Hold on. I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna see how fast I can pull this up. Hang on.
All right. See how fast you
pull it up. Let's go. Anyway, so speaking of Spider-Man, you know, we had. And was there anything about the movie that you didn't like?
That I didn't like.
Yeah.
I always feel that there's not enough Aunt May.
That's gross.
No, not like that. Not like that. I just feel like she's such a good character, and she always kind of. I mean, I know she's a secondary character. I could get that.
Sure.
Right. And, I mean, good. And Marissa Tomei, she's awesome. She's such a fine actress.
Yeah.
Right. And then she's like there for like 30 seconds. She's like, bye. You know what I mean?
She's a side character. You know, she's a side character.
But I feel like I felt like she's been underutilized in these things. She's such a good actress. She has such a powerful storyline to Tom Holland Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Right. She's basically his moral compass, and I don't think she really. And it's not just this movie, it's all of them. There needs to be a Spider-Man Aunt May. Yes, there should be.
All right. I've got the picture queued up, by the way. Like, sorry.
What's that?
I got the picture queued up. Wait, when you're done, dude, to talk to M.A. To M.A.
No, I'm just saying, like, I just feel like she could have had a bigger part to play in this before she got murdered.
Sure. Well, I mean,
spoiler alert. You didn't put your thing up. Aunt May, guys.
Too late. It's gone. It's out there. All right, are you ready to see this?
Let's do it.
Don't make fun of me, okay? Make fun of me. I don't give a shit.
I will make
fun of you. There you go. There you go. This is me. I met Andrew Garfield. We took pictures. We took normal pictures. And then I was like, can I show you my Spider-Man tattoo? And then I showed it to him. And for whatever reason, he's just like, this is the greatest thing. And he kind of like... half hugged me, half like pokes the picture, like pokes the tattoo, and he's just like, "This is awesome." So yeah, what do you think?
I'm not even gonna make fun of you, dude, because that's awesome. I'm gonna say this: I thought he was shorter.
No, he's tall. He's actually.
I'm surprised by.
Yeah, he's kind of like hunching down in that picture.
Yeah. He looks short.
No,
in the films, he just kind of. I've always thought he looks short.
Yeah, no, he's a tall dude. He's a tall dude. In fact, okay, now you're making me. All right, I'm trying to think of like a. Okay, oh, here's the perfect image. Hang on, hold one.
He's got gorgeous hair. Well,
he has really nice hair, and it smelled good. I'm not gonna lie, it smelled good.
Gross, dude.
It smelt very good. It is what it is. Spade is spade. It smelt really good.
I'm going to say this though too about him, is I almost liked him better as Desmond Doss.
As what?
Hacksaw Ridge. Did you ever see Hacksaw Ridge?
Oh yeah. Yeah, when he's the soldier that doesn't kill and he goes out there and does his thing.
He was an actual dude. He was the Medal of Honor winner, Desmond Doss.
Yes, Desmond Doss. Yes.
He was an actual dude. Yeah, I really enjoyed that movie. That was probably the quintessential role for him for me.
Yeah. So here's like one where he's standing almost kind of fully, and yes, you can see he's almost a half head taller than me. And right. I'm an average, maybe a little above average height person because I'm 5'10".
Okay, how tall are you?
I'm 5'10".
Okay, all right. So he's quite a bit taller than. Yeah. So he's what, probably 6'2"?
It's got to be like 6'2", 6'1", 6'2", I would think at least. Let's
okay.
All right. let's see. How tall is Andrew Garfield? Let's see. No, that can't be correct. I don't.
I would say
it says he's 5'10". That's not possible. That's wrong.
If you're 5'10", there's no way he's 5'10".
Right. That is blatantly. I mean, unless was he wearing really tall boots that day? No, he's.
I can't see his boots.
No, he's not 5'10". That
okay? Well, I believe
this is no. Yeah, I believe, incorrect.
If you are 5'10". There is no way he's 5'10".
Okay, maybe
unless
I'm five
you're really hunched over.
Like, yeah, maybe sure. I'm like 5'9¼". I don't know, but I'm that is definitely more than like a half an inch difference.
He says you're 5'5".
Who says I'm 5'5"? No,
Heath Barlow.
You suck a dick. 5'5".
I don't know, dude.
I am not 5'5". God damn it. I'm gonna.
Okay. Anyway, back to the story. Even if you were 5'5", that puts him taller than 5'10".
Yeah, right.
Honestly.
Right.
So, okay, well, that's cool. It's whatever. I'm not going to try to fight with IMDb or wherever you got your information from.
Yeah, I just Googled it and it just came up that he's like literally, not even a site or anything. Just like Andrew Garfield, height, 5'10". There's no way. There's just no way he's 5'10". I'm sorry. No. Anyway, moving on. You know what?
No, it's fine, dude. It's cool. It's just Google.
Moving
it's
on.
Internet, so it can be true.
Google is not an answer machine. It is a search machine.
Oh, so, well, I'll tell you what. Google got me through college. What's up?
It's a search aggregate. Doesn't mean it's true.
Okay, sure.
Anyway. So
yeah, we're gonna get zucked because we're putting up false information on Facebook.
Fake news. Okay, so where we left off.
Maybe you're not 5'10". Are you using the army height still?
Right? Hey, listen. If the army said they issued me the height of 5'10", so I'm 5'10". So
right. It's what you told them at the height and weight. Right before you get taped, I'm 5'10". All right.
All right, the roast to CQ's
yep,
on
February
1st.
I'm 5'8 till I go get taped, and then I'm 5'10". All right, see how that works. Anyway.
All right, guys, the roast of CQ is on February 1st. So let's leave it to then. You guys are warming up.
Anyway.
So where we left off, we were talking about things that I didn't like about the movie. So we talked about that Ned just suddenly is magic, whatever. shut up, guys. Shut up, Scott. So we talk about Ned doing magic, Toby's performance. I said, I felt like not terrible, but he could have,
I just felt to me. Okay. It felt to me
like an old,
you're right. It wasn't the most genuine feeling performance.
Yeah.
I'll give you that. But it also very much felt as the way that he was cast the way his character was written.
And you're right. I'll give you that. That maybe he's not playing Toby, or he's not playing Peter Parker from Amazing Spider-Man 1, 2, or 3. He's playing Peter Parker 20 years later after those events where he's just kind of like, dude, I do it. It's a thing I do.
And he's talking about his back hurting and stuff. Yeah. And you know what I mean?
Like, just
so there's some things there, and I get it. And he is older. Like he's what? He's probably 40, isn't he? How old is he?
My guy. Wasn't he like 26, 27 when he played the part? And that was almost 20 years ago.
All right, hold on. I'm going to Google it.
How old is Toby Maguire? 46 years old.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's something to that, too. Like,
wow, he's my so old. God. 46 years old. God bless.
Yeah.
Anyway.
That's cool, though. No, I don't know. Did they do any, they had to do some, like, age CGI stuff on him, didn't they?
I actually thought that he just came right off the street. It looked like
Willem Dafoe. Willem Dafoe was looking pretty ragged last time I saw him and something. And
yeah.
So imagine they probably did. Okay, now, question on this.
Mm-hmm.
And it was kind of brought up, kind of not. So, okay, we're the I don't even want to call them villains because they kind of weren't villains by the end of it. But well, for sake of our villains, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then they're significant Spider-Men from the same universe? Or were they variants of each other? How do you think that fit in there?
For the, I see what you're saying from like a Loki perspective, that like there's everybody's a variant of everybody is a variant of everybody is a variant. I believe for the simplicity of it, I believe that all the Tobey Maguire villains were from Tobey Maguire's timeline, just much earlier in his timeline. And all the villains of Andrew Garfield were from the Andrew Garfield timeline, just earlier in it. You know, because they talk about, like, I've thought about this for years. I've thought about, you know, the cure for years. So,
right. Well, this is where it got kind of weird for me, and where I was trying to, as because of you, basically, I can't just sit there and enjoy the freaking movie anymore. Right. But I'm sitting there and they're okay. And I'm kind of grasping how time is secular and all the things and blah, 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 and this, that, and the other.
Right.
But why would they pull two things? One, if that caused, right, that messed up spell caused all of the villains, all of the quote unquote people, right, who knew Spider-Man was Peter Parker to come through, there should be an infinite number of Doc Ox, for example, right?
Yes.
Or goblins or whatever. Well, right? So how come
the key is that he said, I stopped the spell, but a few squeaked through.
Okay.
Meaning like the spell didn't take full effect, which would have brought everybody in existence, which is kind of what was happening at the end. It was ripping open and everybody and every variation of everybody was coming. So he said, like, I temporarily stopped it. So, like, remember, it was spinning and then pulls it together. Well, in the pulling it together, just a few people. And that's why I want to say, like, the villains and the Spider-Man are from the same universe, same timeline, because it was just those, like, few little drips squeaked through.
Why would it pull from different points on the same timeline? Does that make sense?
Because it's a fucking movie.
But you see what I'm saying? Like, okay, like,
yes.
People and
but you're trying to come up with a logical.
It makes my brain work like this. I could have 5 years ago. I could have went, sat there, enjoyed the freaking movie, and left. Right,
but
now I gotta like figure.
But you're trying. You're trying to make logic of a thing where, like, well, because they couldn't pull Andrew Garfield from 2006. That's why they pulled him from a different part in the timeline. You know, they didn't want to, spend the money to de-age Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire. I don't know. You know?
I don't know. It just sounds weird.
Well,
here's
the other thing. Here's the other thing. Those villains don't exist at the same time.
Yes.
So even if you said, okay, I want to pull Spider-Man from the moment of the Green Goblin moment, you still to pull Doc Ock, that's 2 years later. That's a different, you know what I mean? So like you're pulling from different times. Yeah, there's no way to logically explain why the Spider-Man, other than it's pulling from when they learned he was Spider-Man. So that's where they're pulling it from in the timeline. But why is the Spider-Man older? Who fucking knows?
Okay, we're beating a dead horse here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So we've got everyone back. And then so everyone went back to their timeline in the exact place they left.
Yeah, they all die. They all die. I know, like, the whole thing was, like, giving them a second chance, but, like, realistically, they all die. Because they got pulled out of the time right before they die, and there's no way to be like, wait, and they're dead. Somebody, right. Although somebody did put together, I saw this on TikTok, somebody put together a really good theory in that we've seen it happen already. And that, like, they play the clip of, you remember Norman Osborn gets impaled by his own glider. And so, like, right. They pull the clip, they go, like, at this moment, when he's like, farewell, Spider-Man, like, he's still bad, but he gets pulled out of time in that moment, brought right back to that time, and then his next line is, oh, no. And, like that's the cured Norman Osborn being returned, and then he still gets impaled, which is why his next line is like, oh, no, like, don't tell Harry. Like, he's like, normal all of a sudden, right? Because the cured guy's returned. Same thing with Doc Ock. Like, he was evil. All of a sudden, Spider-Man said a few things to him, and now he was like, oh, wait, no, I'm good now. It's like, well, because the cured Doc Ock got returned.
That shit fucking crazy anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, just for lack of a better term. Sure. Okay. So anyway, the horse is dead. We beat it. It's done. The only thing left to do is to get really naughty with it.
Anyway, so the only other thing I was gonna say from a storytelling perspective was, like, you know, the idea that they said, oh, these guys got pulled in because they knew Spider-Man was Peter Parker, but Electro never knew Peter Parker was Spider-Man. In fact, they have a scene where he's like, oh shit, I thought you were black. You know what I mean? So
right.
It is what it is. It's storytelling. What are you going to do?
And like I said, there's, I don't know, it kind of is whatever. Yeah. I liked them. Overall, the movie was good. There's some plot holes in it.
Yeah.
If you really want
to
get.
But you just have to enjoy it. Yeah. I think it's a great movie.
Because you're a fucking, you make me start caring about the backstory and the plots and the fuck, blah, 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 blah. Like, where the fuck was Venom at? Oh, guess what? He was just getting drunk at a fucking hotel in fucking Mexico.
I mean, it makes sense.
I mean, that's kind of a Venom thing to do.
That's well, and again, that's this version of Venom. Like, and that's what I remember. I've talked about this before, where, like, this movie Venom version of Tom Hardy, that's the actor. This movie of Eddie Brock and Venom is very different from anything we had in the source comic books. But that makes sense for them. Like, he's a screw up. He's like, he's gonna be sitting there going like, I don't know, I'm just gonna get drunk. Like, that's just him. But the idea that a little drop got left behind, and that might
be it.
That might become something later on. That's nice. Maybe we get a little more comic book accurate Venom within the MCU. Just saying.
Right. Now, question mark. Hashtag question mark.
Sure.
Is MCU going to take that symbiote and put it on Tom Holland?
It's possible.
Or are they going to put it onto the bartender?
I mean, it might hop around. Two most likely scenarios,
okay,
is, in my opinion, is bold predictions. Two most likely scenarios: A, Tom Holland, because we want to see a black suit Spider-Man, and the whole, like, you know, that's the whole part of the Spider-Man's thing is that it becomes the character. The other, which I think, being that the MCU has been trying to do different than other Spider-Man movies, in the comic books, eventually, after Eddie Brock, after Matt Gargan, who's a Scorpion, who also became a Venom later, like, eventually, the Venom suit finds Flash Thompson, and he becomes Agent Venom, and he becomes, like, because Flash Thompson ends up joining the military and becoming, like, a hero and all this, ends up losing his legs, and then through the Venom symbiote, like, they do, a military version of it, where it has, like, psych controls and things so that it doesn't go crazy, whatever. Point is, I could totally see them doing, you know, because we see Flash Thompson in this movie and we see him obsessed with Spider-Man. I want to be his best friend, whatever. What an interesting take would it be, instead of doing the classic Tom Hardy, Eddie Brock Venom relationship, let's go straight to Flash Thompson. Let's go straight to it twists him into going like, well, if you're not going to be my best friend, then I'll destroy you and like make him Venom. And then they can kind of, you know, Tom Holland talks him into being a good guy, and then they can go the whole Agent Venom route where he's now partly.
Well, they're kind of building that West Coast Avengers agent, you know, whatever. I like that idea. That sounds good.
Yeah. So
go with that.
Marvel, if you're looking for a writer, hit me up.
Yeah.
So I do think there is a future for Venom within the Marvel
universe. Well, obviously there is. Or they wouldn't have went through the trouble of all that. I mean, let's be honest.
Yeah, but there's been post-credit scenes that led to nothing in the past. I mean, and sometimes that's just, it is what it is.
We thought Adam Warlock wasn't coming. Now Adam Warlock's coming.
I mean, we knew Adam Warlock was coming. He's a big part of the comics. But I mean more of the sense that Venom is a Sony property. And for all intents and purposes, they did not want to allow MCU to have access to Venom. Like, that was supposed to be a Sony thing, part of their Sony universe, their Spider universe. Same with Morbius and Craven, which is why I still don't understand how we're going to see fucking the Vulture in the Morbius movie when those I don't know. I don't know how they plan on spending all this shit.
But here's the deal, though. This is kind of the way I saw it happening in my brain, my little brain housing group. Sony has their Venom, right? In a different part of – it kind of seems to me, this is kind of what happened with this film and all of the things of what's happened. We've now made all of the Sony Spider-Men canon to the MCU.
Sure.
Right? We've officially made – All of those timelines are now officially canon in the MCU, right? Now we've brought Venom into the MCU, right? The Sony Venom,
right?
Okay,
temporarily.
So that makes temporarily anyway, but it makes him canon. That brings him into this universe,
sure,
right?
Yes.
Into this main timeline.
Yes.
Now, because the symbiote's there, the Marvel can do something different with the same character and not really interfere with the Sony property. They can't. It's all going to be licensed. Everyone's going to make money on it. They don't really give a shit at this point who makes the fucking thing, right? So, but now we've got, I mean, even if you just brought him in as, like you said, a whole different than the Eddie Brock timeline that the Sony's got going on, whether you bring it in into Flash or whether you bring it into Tom Holland or you bring it into someone completely fucking out of left field and just make him like a villain in the next Spider-Man movie. I mean, you could do. There's so many different things for him to do that don't really interfere with the Sony property, so they can keep making their money, and you know, Marvel is going to license it to give them more money. Everyone's going to make money,
maybe
except for Radar. Radar ain't making no money. You're going to make money from writing it, but I mean,
Donald in the chat says, "Let me in the box. I can counter that." By all means, call in.
Yeah,
call in or type it in. I'd love to hear a fellow nerd's take on it. You know the number, right? 415-889-8367. Call the number, man. We always take calls. Somebody was trying to call during the interview, and I apologize in the chats to them because they're like, I thought I could call in. I'm like, you can, but not during interviews.
Don't interrupt the interview. Radar doesn't even interrupt the interview.
Radar knows better.
Sorry. I'm sorry about it. I'm sorry about it.
But, okay, so yeah.
Talking about post-credit scenes here, right? And Venom just got... But Venom doesn't know that Tom Holland or that Peter Parker is Spider-Man, does he?
I mean, even if he did... Well, he did. If you remember the post-credit scene of Venom, he saw the news that showed Spider-Man demasked.
But yeah, but that was after he got brought into the timeline.
That was before he. Well, yes. Technically, he got zapped in. He was in this. So you're saying he shouldn't have been brought in because Venom shouldn't have known Spider-Man even exists, right? So that's a common. Yes. A lot of people say that. Here's where I think they sneaked it in. It's a very clever line. When, in that post-credit scene, before Venom gets snapped, Eddie's talking to the Venom symbiote, and the Venom symbiote is like, I have access to hundreds of thousands of years of knowledge across universes, because he's connected to the hive mind. So the idea is that their hive mind, remember, there was a Venom in Spider-Man 3, and because that Venom knew Peter Parker, Spider-Man, it connects to the hive mind, therefore he knows.
Okay. So he's basically like, for lack of a better term, a Nexus being. He's like Wanda.
Kind of in a way.
Okay.
In a way.
Okay.
Doesn't have the power of a Wanda, but the kind of the knowledge base. Yeah.
Right. Okay. I'm checking.
Yeah. Yep. So, I mean, I had the same thing of like, well, wait a minute. Spider-Man doesn't even exist in his universe. Why did he get pulled? And then I was watching somebody do a breakdown, and they were talking about, well, in that very specific line, which you know was placed there because it was part of the post-credit scene. Yeah, and we have to explain.
There's no accidents.
Yeah.
No accidents in the MCU.
We have to explain why he's getting pulled in. So they literally put that line of where I, my hive mind knowledge goes across universes hundreds of thousands of years. So because there's a Venom that does know Spider-Man was Peter Parker, therefore this Venom knows, and therefore
I get it. Okay.
Portaled over.
All right.
But yeah. Anyway.
While we're talking about post-credit scenes.
Yeah. Let's do it.
Well, that was mid-credit scene. I'm going to go to the post-credit scene.
Post-credit scene.
Ooh, okay. So I thought, and we kind of discussed, that the possibility of Wanda being either an anti-hero mm-hmm. or the villain mm-hmm. in the upcoming Doctor Strange, mm-hmm. in the forthcoming Doctor Strange. It sure looks that that's not the case anymore, right? Appears that she is going to be Strange sought her out.
Trailers can be misleading.
I know, but here's from the trailer. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Strange sought her out, and she immediately apologized for having a Westview and blah, 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 blah. And
like, bitch, kinda, that's and old then, news.
That's old news. I need your help.
Yeah.
Okay. So, being the Sorcerer Supreme, he knows about her powers.
Mm-hmm.
Her abilities.
Sure. He knew about what happened to Westview, so he was aware. Yeah,
he knew about what happened to Westview, and I'm sure that's probably old news, kind of. But and this is what I don't understand about I guess he's not Sorcerer Supreme anymore, but that's another story. Whatever,
right.
Whatever. That was a bombshell. But anyway, so when in Shang-Chi, when he used the rings, right? Mm-hmm. They felt the power of the rings, kind of thing, right? Mm-hmm. So when Wanda uses her powers, they can feel the power at the Sanctum Sanctorum and all that shit, right? So they have an idea as to what power she does have, sure, and the amount of power she has and this, that, and the other. So he recruits her to help him fight this mysterious villain. Now, we get to the villain part, and it's Strange Supreme. Or is it not Strange Supreme? Is it the same guy from... Okay.
It could be Crunchy Strange Supreme.
Okay.
Sorry, that's a Taco Bell reference. Supreme.
I do like
French Wrap Supreme.
Yep. It just means it has sour cream. So this is
I'm just hungry. Cream. Can you tell I'm just hungry?
Okay. So spoiler for anyone who hasn't seen fucking What If.
Way
but Strange
it.
Supreme was locked himself in the
yeah.
in the deal.
I don't think it's him. I don't think it's him. I think this is going to be, along those lines when I say like dark dimension Strange, but the whole idea of Multiverse of Madness is that there are multi verses. So yes, in another universe, without it being Strange Supreme, which was from the What If show, there could be another universe where he's just an evil dark version of Doctor Strange without it actually being could it be, dude? You want to take next, when they talk about, the Disney Plus shows will merge into the movies, which will merge into the Disney Plus, you want to take that next level, then have the balls to make a cartoon character now fully realized in an MCU movie, and they'll have all the respect in the world. And there is one shot in that trailer. There's one shot that makes me go, Do you remember in that episode, the Strange Supreme episode, when he finally realized, oh, I might have fucked up, is like when he steps outside and like it's getting like all the stuff are getting like the bubbles and like the world starting to fade away. There's a shot in that trailer, very similar, like a but a live action version of it, where it's the city and it's kind of collapsing in on itself and it's getting this weird like bubbly like,
yes,
fading away.
That's so why, that's what I don't know, dude. Like, oh man, do we want it to be? Do you want it to be Stranger? Because okay. It kind of seems as though if he's going to be the villain, he himself is almost too powerful to be defeated, right? It almost takes him kind of realizing that he fucked up to be stopped. Not like Thanos, who can be beat, right?
Yeah.
Or I'm... like Kang, who eventually beats himself with Kang.
If
I beat myself in the movie theater, I get kicked out. So I don't know about it.
This would be weird.
But I'm just saying.
No.
So you see what I'm saying? Like, he's almost too powerful a villain to fight. He's going to have to be like brought back around kind of
thing. Yeah. I don't know. It's too early to tell. You know, we still have all the way till May till we really know for sure. But I think it's too early to tell who's going to be the real big bad of this. I think they're keeping it kind of like they did with Spider-Man. They're going to keep us guessing for a while. All I know is that there is a rumor that because we're seeing, you know, the multiverse, which means not only will we see different versions of characters we know, we'll also see characters we know in different versions. And by that, I mean there's a rumor, for those that don't know, before Robert Downey Jr. was ever cast as Iron Man, the first person they offered the role to and who they wanted to play Iron Man was Tom Cruise. We've talked about this before. And there's a rumor. There's a rumor that Tom Cruise will do a cameo as Iron Man, as Tony Stark Iron Man in this movie. The same way how we have two Spider-Mans that look totally different, or three Spider-Mans that look totally different. Like, there's going to be another Tony Stark, and it's going to be Tom Cruise. But again, just as a cameo.
The MCU is the last bastion of good films that haven't fucked with Tom Cruise. Don't do it now.
I think it'd be great. I'd love to see it. I'm on record.
Doing your fucking booty. Yep. Okay, go ahead.
Tom Cruise sucks.
On
record that says I don't need him in a movie, like a whole. I just need him in a scene. Like the fucking.
You know what I want to see? I want to see the new Top Gun movie. When's that coming out?
Later.
Tom Cruise, figure that shit out before you start fucking with my MC.
He's finished Top Gun. They're just not releasing it for some reason. It was supposed to come out in November.
Like outer space? He was going to go out in outer space.
That's a different thing. He was going to shoot a movie in outer space. Yeah.
Yeah, there's no COVID in outer space. Pretty sure about it.
Well, you can take it to outer space. Great.
Sit there for 2 weeks on his own. It's only like he's quarantined. What anyway. Better place to quarantine than outer freaking space? Anyway, that made our rant over. Okay, but so Doctor Strange 2 is the next film that's coming out.
The next MCU movie proper is Doctor Strange.
And that's coming out in March.
May.
Right?
May.
God damn it.
Yeah, we got to wait.
That's a long ways away.
We got a long way to go.
It's like 5-6 months away. That's a long time.
Yep.
Well, that's what I was looking forward to. So we'll get some more. We'll have some more trailers and spoilers and all that stuff coming out about it.
Oh yeah.
Kind of excited about it.
Yeah, man. No, later. I'm
honestly,
excited.
If I'm honest, I kind of wasn't. I thought Quantumania was supposed to come out before
No. Multiverse of Madness. Then something else, then Quantumania.
I don't know. Is it like Thor, Love, and Thunder, then Quantum?
It's something like that. Something along those lines. I have this information saved for a very specific reason. There it is. January, Morbius. February, Uncharted, based on the video game. March is The Batman. April has Secrets of Dumbledore, which is the Fantastic Beasts spinoff. April has Sonic 2. May has Doctor Strange Multiverse of Madness. Also in May is Top Gun Maverick, which, again, might be letting line up. Also in May is John Wick Chapter 4. June has the next Jurassic Park. July has Thor, Love and Thunder. That's the next one after Doctor Strange. July, Thor, Love and Thunder. Also July is Black Adam. October has Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse Part 2, Part 1, which kind of makes sense. Across the Spider-Verse Part 1. November has Flash. Also has Wakanda Forever. And
what is going on with Wakanda Forever? Because it sure seems to be like
there's a lot. There's a lot.
Is that even going to be a thing? It sure feels like it's like a.
They're filming it. Issues. It's definitely going to be a thing. It's just so real quick. One of the big people to have a big part of it is what's her name, Letitia Wright, who plays Shuri. Is going to be a big part of that sequel, obviously, and got injured while filming, like dislocated her shoulder really badly, and so they actually have to. They're like, oh, she's just going to rest for a little while and we'll shoot all the stuff without her. So they shot for like a month without her. And then they were like, well, turns out her injury's a lot worse than we thought it was. And so they shut down production. And they said they're just going to shut it down until January. So it's been shut down for a couple weeks. And they're going to let her heal. And then they're going to pick up production in January. So, you know, but there's also been some rumors that she's been saying some things that's rubbing people the wrong way.
They're not fan of the coof spray and stuff.
Yeah. So she's been saying certain things and that's getting people riled up about certain things. And so, yeah, it's not been great news coming out of that, but.
And that's whatever. Like I kind of get that a little bit. I hadn't heard really for sure, like kind of, what's going on with that? I hear rumors.
Yeah, I hear.
And things. I know that you've got your ear to the ground a little better than I do when it comes to these things. So
it's that old Game of Thrones line: I drink and I know things.
Right, and I'm out of beer. So,
but anyway, to end this wonderful episode, I loved Spider-Man. I saw it multiple times. If you haven't seen it?
How many times did you see it? By the way,
To see it four times. I saw it three times. I gave one set away because I felt like,
yeah, if I'd have lived, it went.
Yeah, it was a great movie. I'm very happy with how it went. With all the hype,
let me ask you this before you get much into this. Of those movies we just listed off, mm-hmm. are you as excited to see any of those as you were to see Spider-Man? Before, because I know you're a huge Spider-Man fan. You have him on your arm.
Yeah.
Right. So you are predetermined to enjoy Spider-Man movies. And you were really looking forward to this one.
Yes.
And not so much Eternals. I know you weren't really as looking forward to it as Spider-Man. These movies coming out in the next, say the next three that are coming out.
Mm-hmm.
Are you
specifically
as
MCU
for
or just in general?
In general. Are you as excited to see any of these movies coming out as you were to see Spider-Man No Way Home?
Looking ahead at all the movies coming out.
Yes.
The closest of excitement. I don't think no. I think the answer is no, that there's nothing that as exciting. Like the hype, that's what I was going to say right before you come in. The hype for this movie was so intense. So intense with the secrecy and with the things and there was just so much going into it. And obviously being a big fan and loving this thing and loving the idea that there may be old Spider-Mans and all that. The only thing that comes close for me in terms of excitement, would probably be across the Spider-Verse Part 1. So the sequel to the animated Spider-Man movie. And then other than that, then Doctor Strange, I really do feel like that's going to be a really cool, really cool movie. And here's why.
Okay.
I feel this was testing the waters on a small scale, what they intend to do with Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness, where instead of just going like, oh, we're sampling from these three Spider-Man universes, Multiverse of Madness, they get to kick open the door. And say like, fuck it. What do you guys want? You want to bring in fucking like I said, Tom Cruise as Iron Man? Boom, he's in the movie cameo. Everybody's been fan casting Norman Reedus to be Ghost Rider. boom, they can bring him in for a scene, right? Because they don't have to stick to anything. None of this has to be canon in the sense of like, well, now they're part of the universe, right? Because it could just be a multiversal. We're jumping from thing to thing, and oh, there's a Fantastic Four, right? Like, right. And none of it has to be permanent. So they get to play more, and that's a rumor of why they're doing 6 weeks of reshoots, is because they wanted to put more cameos in the movie. They wanted to film more stuff with more random people. Now, when I say that this was the small sample, that will be the entree, but I think that is only going to build to the next step. Stay with me now. There's a storyline in the comic books. This hasn't been announced, but there's a storyline in the comic books called Secret Wars. Secret Wars was awesome. Secret Wars was Battle World. It was where entities on such a massive level, like cosmic beings beyond anything we've seen so far, even in Eternals, were like, we want to see who would win in a straight up good versus evil fight. And they basically plucked all the heroes and all the villains and put them on Battle World and said, fuck it, go at it. Let's see who wins. So there's a strong theory, a hunch, a feeling in the universe that we're building to that, right? We saw the small Spider-Man little sample here. In Multiverse of Madness, we're going to see more. We're going to see universal hopping. And that will build to a secret war, whether it's 2 years, 3 years, 4 years from now, but do secret war where they can bring back, they can do anything. They can bring back, they can bring back the original X-Men. They can bring back the Fantastic Four, the shitty Fantastic Four that we got, the one with the Michael B. Jordan, which would be hilarious to see Michael B. Jordan back as his character from Fantastic Four after having played Killmonger. That would be really funny to see. But like they can just do whatever they want and just go ham on multi-universal stuff. But anyway,
they should have the Hulk from the 70s.
They could, that dude. Lou Ferrigno.
Funny. Paint him green. This is what I mean, though.
Yeah.
So we've got all these things that they can go with, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that ultimately is the exciting spot that they can really go pretty far with this, right?
Yeah.
Now we got the Secret Wars timeline. We got introduced to He Who Remains slash Kang.
Oh yeah.
In Loki.
Yeah.
We're going to get introduced him even further. He will be even bigger in. He's not going to be in Doctor Strange or no, or do you know? What do you think? Do you think he'll be in Doctor Strange at all? Or is he just, were we holding off for him to Ant-Man, Quantumania?
Possibly.
Kind of like towards the end, kind of like in Loki.
Yeah. It could be like a nod. Like they end up in one universe and like it's already kind of taken over. Yeah. And then they kind of jump, like, you know, they don't like deal with it. They just kind of move on. But it's just like a nod to that it's there.
Well, because here's the thing. Like here, we know there's a Loki season 2 coming, right? We know that's coming. Mm-hmm. They said that. But I feel like, okay, us as an audience, we know if you watch Loki anyway, mm-hmm. the people who watch Disney Plus shows, know that there's a lot going on behind the scenes right now, and things like in Spider-Man when the stars are ripping open, mm-hmm. right, and it looks very similar to what happened in Loki with the
multiverse timeline kind of
branching off and things like so. We know that there's other things happening that if you just saw the films, you don't know are happening.
Right.
We have to get at some point. Loki is going to have to get with Doctor Strange or Wanda or somewhere and be like, hey, this is what the fuck's going on, dude. We killed this guy and now shit's happening and the multiversal war. That's still going to happen.
Does he, though?
I mean, okay, this maybe I think he does. I think that has to be addressed. We can't just be like, oh, now you're going to start a multiversal war and then be like, bye, I'll see you. And then it's just going to be a fucking Disney Plus show. Like this is a pretty big deal too. Like
here's the thing,
and this is where I'm going to say this, and I know that you're a huge Marvel fan. The whole reason we have the show is to talk about Marvel movies and pop culture stuff. But okay, we've got Secret Wars coming, basically, right? Got this multiversal.
Maybe
we've got Galactus coming. We've got all these things happening or rumors of it happening.
Mm-hmm.
How much can they do? without diluting it and making it shit?
That's a good question.
You see what I mean? Like,
that's a good question. It's a fair question.
When you look at the movies over the last 10 years, mm-hmm. and how many of them have been not necessarily all Marvel movies, but superhero movies. Comic franchise.
Have you seen a Fast and Furious movie lately? Apparently, you can do whatever you want and still make $1 billion.
Nobody has. People will go to it, but the only reason people go to that is because fucking Paul Walker drove like an idiot, hit a fucking tree. That's the only reason people go to those. They're not actually good movies. No one likes Fast and the Furious. No one actually likes them.
They make a bajillion dollars, so they keep making them.
A bunch of money. You know what makes a fuck ton of money? Meth dealers. Doesn't make it right.
Makes it good.
Make it popular.
Makes it good.
Doesn't make it something that any of us want to be part of.
I mean, apparently somebody's enjoying it. That's all I'm saying.
All I'm saying is, like, okay, right now, part of the lure to me, to Radar.
Yes.
Okay. I like the stories. Mm-hmm. But more importantly, I like the production value. Sure. I like that it's
quality.
The stories, right? It's a quality production.
Yeah.
Right. Now, if they start putting out Iron Man 3s and fucking Thor Ragnaroks nonstop.
You mean Thor Dark World? Because Ragnarok was a good movie.
Ragnarok was funny, but it was a stupid fucking movie. It was dumb.
I liked Ragnarok. The movie was dumb. I thought
the
movie
it didn't really it just kind of jumped all over the place. Didn't really explain nothing. It was kind of dumb. Like,
now we're getting into a philosophical question about that.
In all fairness, but okay, but I'm just saying, if they start putting out crap movies, how many people like Radar are going to go watch it? People like you who really give a shit about the MCU and the canon, the comic book, and other brands. People are always going to go. Right.
Sure.
But I'm not going to go to the movie theater and see all those people.
The question. I think for you, the question is the ROI, the return on investment, right? Because of how much they're putting into these movies, they have to continually do better and better and better. Yes. And at some point, and we've talked to guests about this, there is going to be a fatigue set in, and that ROI is going to go down and down and down. And it's going to cross a threshold where they go, well, it's just not worth making them anymore.
Right.
You know? So, I mean, possibly.
Because the zombie genres kind of did that.
Yeah. Yeah. The zombies, vampires. We had a thing of vampires for a while. We had a thing about, you know, there was a lot of magic stuff for a while. There's phases.
This has lasted longer than most of those.
Yeah. You well, but because of the good quality, I think that's what's kept it around.
Absolutely. One can argue The Walking Dead they had pretty good quality for the first couple of years, especially as a television show.
Yeah.
But it's still around. Really? But it's like a Fast and the Furious movie. Yeah. I'm not going to watch it. I know it's like Snakes on the Plane. How many of those do that now? Or Sharknadoes or the fuck ever.
What I want to do.
Yeah. Yes.
I don't know if the audience can see it, but like, the last 5 minutes of you talking and getting really passionate and fired up about these movies and very specific circumstances, I want to like clip that and compare it to Radar from like episode 2 or 3. You're like, what the fuck's a Spider-Man? What the fuck's Iron Man?
I thought they're the same person for a while. They both wear red. They're both in comic.
You're like, what's the difference between Marvel and DC? They're all people in tights. The difference.
In all fairness, that's not too far off a fucking observation.
I'm just saying.
They're all a bunch of fucking dudes in tights jumping around the fucking universe.
The difference in Radar 2 years ago, the actual unpop cultured Radar versus now the pop cultured Radar.
You have to do co-host just to get someone in here who doesn't know what I'm talking about.
This is, it now, does my heart good.
For like half an hour now, and I'm just gonna keep talking.
I know.
Actual.
I know, but it does my heart good that we have brainwashed you, and won you over, got you to the dark side, and won you over. So, I'm happy. I can go to bed happy tonight, knowing that.
You know what made me really happy about all this? On this note, so two of the guys I work with are big in comic book nerd kind of people, mm-hmm. right? We're in it like how you were before I got into it, like thing, right?
Sure.
They've been in it for years, all in the comic books, and know all the storylines and stuff. And I saw Spider-Man this weekend. They didn't.
Wow. That says something. When you sent me the picture of you in the theater, Bro, I damn near like shed a tear. I was like, this is the guy that does not go to the theater for nothing. And to know that it was Spider-Man that brought you out. Oh, brought a tear to my eye. Scott says, uncultured radar be like, why can't Vader and Spider-Man fight? Aren't they all Disney?
I still think that'd be fucking awesome.
I mean, technically they exist within the same universe. You saw Spider-Man playing with the Star Wars Legos, so.
Yep, they are a thing.
They are technically in the same universe. Just
that'd be fucking hilarious, wouldn't it?
Anyway.
Just for like, talking about cameos, funny cameos. How funny would that be? Like they're flipping through the timeline and all of a sudden like Vader is just standing there with like a fucking lightsaber and goes to like swing it and all of a sudden Strange is like, nope, bye, see ya.
Only if. Was it Mickey Mouse? Mickey Mouse is Disney, right? They flip to another universe and it's just all Disney characters like Mickey Mouse, Donald Duck, fucking
like Frozen live action or something.
Yes. They're like, ho ho! You're like, Jesus Christ! It's a 5 foot mouse.
That's why the Sanctum Sanctorum was all fucking iced over because Strange has got an affair going on with fucking the chick from Frozen
Elsa,
or something.
Elsa, yeah.
Elsa. God, that'd be hilarious when it just. Just some like quick, it doesn't have to be like anything, but just a quick cameo of Kylo Ren.
It's Doctor Strange going, listen, it was fun, but you got to let it go.
Yep.
Get it. Good thing there.
The chick from Mandalorian.
All righty, ladies and gentlemen. We have come to the end of not just this episode. Mm-hmm. We've come to the end of Pop Culture Warrior. Circa 2021.
Yes.
This is the final sign-off of Pop Culture Warrior in the year of our Lord, 2021. There will not be a Pop Culture Warrior next week, December the 28th. No. We will return in the new year, the year 2022, on January 4th. And we're going to have a great guest for that show. And a great guest. A guy who does voiceover work and does incredible celebrity voice impersonations. I'm going to post it, but he has a great video of doing a Ryan Reynolds in front of Ryan Reynolds. It's hilarious. It is so hysterical. Anyway. So we'll be back with that, Mr. Raider. I know we are shifting gears here at the station and going into our holiday break, but
yes.
But for those that don't know, what would a typical week in the world of WTF Nation Radio look like?
Well, a normal week, normally on Tuesdays, you listen to Pop Culture Warriors, CQ and Radar, which you did tonight. You did do that. CQ, I'm Radar. We were here. Okay, Wednesdays, we have Wednesdays off, Donzas, days of no scheduled activities. You're going to see a few of those in our schedule. If you've been in the military, you probably know what that means. But now, in case you're not, now you know what it means. We'll not be here Wednesday. Now, Thursday, normally, is going to be Soren's time with Ice and Spanky talking all things Big Army, National Guard, Reserves, Retirees, Big Army. They're sergeants, and they're going to be sergeanting, telling you all kinds of things that y'all need to know. Now, Friday. It's Friday Night Freedom, okay? It's going to be Pookie, who was on here earlier. Bye, hi, Pookie. I don't know where you went, okay? And his man, Cause. They're going to be doing all kinds of crazy shit. They have a fun, fun show. You need to be there. Check them out, okay? Now, Saturday this week is Christmas. Merry Christmas, everybody. Anyway, that's what we're going to be doing. I'll be hanging out with my fam. Hope they get to hang out with your fam. Enjoy your family for Christmas if you are inclined to celebrate. Now, Sunday, day off. Another Don's a day, okay? Monday, the Monday edition, aptly named because it's on Monday night. That's got Ice and Mom, sometimes me, sometimes another co-host. Kind of depends on what's going on, okay? That's on a normal Monday. Next Monday, they're off because, you know, a Christmas thing. Now, that's all talking about current events, all kinds of crazy shit, okay? Good show. Be there. Now, after Monday is Tuesday. Every Tuesday, we have the Pop Culture Warrior. That's him, CQ, Pop Culture Warrior. I'm Radar, his yin to his yang. Okay. I don't even know if I'm that anymore because now I'm getting more pop cultured. I'm not the voice of the unpop cultured anymore.
You are not.
I'm just dumb. Now I just bring up stupid, far away scenarios, and CQ's got to keep me grounded because I'm pretty sure there's going to be mutants in Hawkeye. But anyway, we'll discuss that not next week, but the week after, because next week is our vacation. Holla. Anyway, thanks for hanging out with us. I hope you have a Merry Christmas, and genuinely, thank you so much. You guys are the reason we're here, and I really do appreciate it. So, yes. I'm out.
Yes. Excellent. Wonderful wrap-up for the new year. Guys, look forward. Look forward to what we've got coming up, both here at Pop Culture Warrior and across the WTF Nation. There's lots of really fun stuff in store. Some big changes. I'm not talking about yet, but there's some big things coming. Very excited for. And yeah, man, 2022 is going to be, it's going to be awesome.
It's going to be off the chain. It's going to be so fun.
It's going to be.
And we're going to do nothing but grow and have a good time. And we're going to hang out. And we won't talk about Hawkeye. Well, we'll talk about Hawkeye not next week, the week after. But
next episode.
So, yep.
Awesome, guys. You all have been awesome. So yeah. Thank you all for making this as much fun. We couldn't have do it without you. Merry Christmas if you celebrate. Happy holidays if you don't. Happy New Year. And guys, we'll see you in 2022. This is CQ. He's Radar. Signing off. We'll see you guys soon. Shots. Say bye, Radar.
Ah, Radar.
Bye, guys. We'll be right back.